Father, we thank you for the great outpouring of the Holy Ghost. Father, we thank you for the wonderful works of Jesus in our midst. Father, I pray right now that every person standing in this place will respond to the opportunity that you've given to us to walk in your glory, to walk in your majesty. That every person will come and recognize the price that there is to pay, the separation under the call that you demand in these last days, that there be no mixture, that we come to a realm of obedience and submission to the Holy Ghost. So, Lord, that you may do those things that bring honor and glory to your only begotten Son, so that you may do those things that break off the yoke and the blindness of heart and mind. Father, we thank you for once again moving in a great wave of your mercy and a great wave of your grace throughout the United States of America. And we thank you, Father, that you're raising up people who do it with you. Now, let me just say this, because this is the state of affairs. Everybody wants to be in the majestic moving of his presence and see the glory of his mighty works being performed. But there are very few people that are willing to pay the price. There are very few people who are willing to come to a place of complete and total submission to the Lord Jesus Christ and obedience to do the things that he has commanded us to do and learn and be taught to do it exactly like he said so in his word. But the beautiful thing of it is, the amazing thing of it is he's opened up the door to anyone, anybody. Now, you say me? Yes, you. And then you think, well, I've been wanting and I've been hoping and I've been praying, but it really hasn't seemed to work out that way. Well, these things in the realms of circumstance and situation and time, as it were, would come and try to discourage you and steal your confidence. Don't cast away your confidence. It's got a big payday. It's got, if you want to say it the way the King James said it, it's got a great recompense of reward. I like payday. It's easier to say, and everybody knows exactly what we're saying. Hallelujah. I just decided to go ahead and surrender my all to Jesus. Hallelujah. I decided to just go ahead and consecrate myself to the King of Kings and live now as though I were living in heaven. Decided to no longer live unto myself. Hallelujah. And you know, it may seem a little bit easier when you've trodden this path of pastoral ministries and just been doing this as long as I've been doing it. I've been walking around saying things similar to this for many years. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But reality of it is right where you are right now, right where you stand right now, there's an opportunity waiting for you that God would take you, shape you, mold you, and prepare you to do his great and wonderful works in the midst of a dry and thirsty land. Reality of it is we've too much have been willing to take the assaults of Satan and the assaults of darkness and the hindrances that realm brings and just go ahead and just sit down and just let it be. And there isn't a real ferocious response that should exist in our lives. But tonight, I just pray in Jesus' name that you get such a passion for the ministry of Jesus, for the things that he has purchased us with his own blood to be. That you say, okay, Father, I'm ready to participate. I want to do this. And when that happens, he's going to shine a floodlight on your life and show you all your nonsense. He's going to show you all your earthly stuff, all your self-interest stuff that produces every bad thing for you, like shame and condemnation and guilt and I can't do it and give up and, you know, look to drink from the world rather than standing fast and knowing that, hallelujah, there's a water of living, there's a living water, the water of life, hallelujah, there for you. Praise the name of Jesus. See, the thing about it is what I feel and what I sense in my spirit. It's a great outpouring of the Holy Ghost. I feel in a sense of my spirit a transition into greater faith, an increase. I feel a transition. Ha, mahandadeya, hudasetayapa. I hear the Spirit of the Lord calling us up into another dimension of faith. Oh, what can you do with the gift of faith, says the Lord? Oh, well, then you can do anything, he says, with the gift of faith. You can speak to this mountain, it will obey you. You can say to the sycamine tree, be plucked up by the roots and planted in the sea. And whatever you ask or whatever you say, it will come to pass. Jesus. I'll just tell you right now. Somebody said, how long are you going to seek? How long are you going to wait on the Lord? As long as it takes. Well, shouldn't you get discouraged? No, I won't. All I'm gonna do is press in that much harder, press in that much more. I'm gonna watch. Hey, listen, the day of the Lord is certain. The movings of God are certain. Father looks for those who will follow on to know him. And those that follow on to know him will experience his sovereign movings. And his sovereign movings come to us as the early and the latter rain. Hosea said so. And he knew what he was talking about. Hallelujah. He was a bona fide prophet speaking on behalf of Almighty God. That's why he's got a book in the Bible. Hallelujah. Hosea chapter 6, verse 2. Then I recognize that Father is waiting for a precious fruit of the earth. It's like we want to be hybrids. We want a little bit of the world and we want a little bit of the kingdom of God. We want a little bit because here's the insult of hell. Let me tell you the insult of hell, the intimidation of hell, the harassment of demon spirits. Oh, you can't be so heavenly minded that you're no earthly good. What a blasphemous lie from hell. You become heavenly minded and you'll change the world around you. It's the only earthly good that there is. It's the only earthly good that there is. And oh, what a great joy. Oh, what a great peace. Oh, what a great purpose. When you step into who you are supposed to be in God the Holy Ghost, everything about you, everything about society, everything about the people around you, everything about the demonic realm is set against you stepping into who God's purposed you to be. Satan wants to define you. Man wants to define you. Your peers want to define you. The world around you want to define you. And because you're so close and so up in your face and so visible, you let them. But what happens if you step out of that? You begin to let God, the Holy Ghost, define you. You begin to hear a call into the realms of the Spirit. I'm telling you, I believe that if God's people would just simply begin to seek his face, that there would become such an overwhelming Holy Ghost conviction and awareness of the divine presence that so many people will then begin to take a hold of that which God has for them. And I'm, for one, I'm set on it. But you know what? In the midst of a church, it really should be everyone. Ultimately, what God does is this. It comes to a crossroads, and he decides to use anyone. And usually it's one. He comes to a crossroads where Father is now saying, no, I'm going to lift up the banner of my son. I'm going to raise up, as it were, deliverers in Zion. I'm going to show forth my power. And then everybody just gets swept over with the presence and the power of God. There's waves of glory. And then out of that, we begin to see people then move forward and step forward into this glorious liberty. But I want you to participate with it now when it seems as though that glory and that wonderful convicting power that I'm talking about, that wonderful spirit of wisdom and revelation that brings insight to us to know who we are and who He is, even though it may not be as strong right now as it has been in days gone by, and it is going to be in the very near future, you can lay hold on God. And in doing that now, right now, doing that now, understanding the convicting Holy Ghost moving power that is here present right now, the call of the Spirit of the Lord to come be separate, the call of the Spirit of the Lord to come and be filled up with everything that He has for you, all the results. Ah, the results. Just have a seat for a minute. All the results. All the results. All the results, Alyssa. All the results, Jacqueline. All the results, Zoe. What Father is present here to do right now. Basta con rimandare le bestie piandolomo. What the moving of the power of God is here, willing to confer to each person in this place, transfer to each person in this place at this very moment, not later, now. Some of you, it's a very small step to step over into a greater dimension of the working of faith. Some of you, it is a complete rearrangement of your life. Oh, what it would be, and we're just believing God for it, that all the little ones, like Anna and all of these little ones, that every day of their life, they're willing to be conformed to the ways of the kingdom of God, rather than having some model that's running interference with it and wanting to do it your own way. Listen, parents, if you want to do things your own way, it's going to get off on your children. But if you begin to humble yourself and seek the Lord to do things His way, to have that which He's provided for us to have. Hallelujah. I don't want to say it's infectious because that would be the wrong word to use. It will, everybody in your house. It's a contagion. It's contagious. It's a Holy Ghost contagion. Jesus. All just to know and understand what He wants to do with you right now. The moving of the Spirit is available for you right in front of you. While you try so hard to listen with your ears, but right there's something you can grab with your heart. Right now, there's something that you can grab with your spirit. Right now, there's a realm of divine power and glory that will change everything about your life. It'll change, it will redefine for you what you want. It will take away your earthly ambitions entirely, so be careful. You will be one with only heavenly ambitions, and it'll be glorious. Think about how many earthly ambitions you have. It's in the way. Just in the way. And boy, does that ever go over big. Just in the way. Oh, if you start going after the things of the Spirit and begin to have those heavenly ambitions that Father has for you, He's going to give you more than your earthly ambitions would have ever achieved. Or ever gained for you. But you're going to have something far more. You're going to have a fellowship with the divine power and a fellowship over in the realms of His glory. You have a fellowship with Christ Jesus. You're going to have a fellowship with the Holy Spirit. You're going to have a reality of heaven. You're going to be such a fenced city that nothing of the powers of darkness will even be able to touch you. I'm looking again to see those holy men and women full of the Holy Ghost that were around when I was a little guy, who knew, who were just there. They praying all the time, doing the things that they needed to get done in terms of their responsibility, but also full of the Holy Ghost. They tongues and interpretation of tongues anytime, drop of a hat. Prophecy anytime. A prayer, an authority in God. Laying on the hands for the sick, which is fundamental to the church. We want to see that happen again. But see, people, the church drifted too much into the world to have that. You have to be separated unto God to have this. You have to be consecrated unto the realm of the Lord to have these things. Otherwise, they won't be burning on the inside of you. The world will put the fire out. But it's going to happen again. I just see what's going to happen with me. It's happening with me. Hallelujah. There's one amen, three looks, and the rest are just sitting there. What's happening with you? Is that it? Is that all that's happening with you? What's happening with you? Are you going to sit there in shock land, or are you going to step up and begin to grab a hold of and lay hold on the things that the Spirit of the Lord says? You know, you've got an opportunity. You don't want to be on hold, because all that does is manifest that you're still in neutral. You haven't decided yet. You're more on the side of, ooh, he's talking about me. Yeah, I do have a lot of ambitions that are earthly. Not sure I want to change. You with me? Let the Spirit of the Lord begin to produce within your heart hunger, because I'm not talking nonsense. I'm telling you what Father is saying right out of heaven. And then you have the choice as to whether or not you want to do that. Now, you can ultimately get stuck in a repose that says, well, I don't know how to do that. I'm so in up over my head that there's no way out of hell for me. There's no way out of all my earthly obligations. Oh, yeah, there is. Hallelujah. You're not there yet. You're not in hell yet. You're not in a prison yet. Hallelujah. You right here at the door of opportunity. Everything about your decision making, everything about your choices has got to change. Yeah. Amen. And everything about your decision making and everything about your choices is going to have to be turned over to a realm where you're now just saying, yes, Holy Spirit. Yes, Lord. You read the Word of God. Yes, I'm going to go do that. And then when you don't find it, somebody said, I just don't feel the hunger. I just don't feel the thirst. I don't just feel the motivation. Then you recognize it's nothing but a demon spirit that you've allowed to oppress you, and you need to break through that thing. And there's a number of ways that you can. And the first thing would be, would just begin to lift up your voice and begin to praise Him and begin to consecrate yourself to obedience and begin to pray and begin to fast and pray and begin to wait upon the Lord in every way. You're not waiting on God. This is what you need to know. God's waiting on you. The gifts of the Spirit, the outworking of the power of the Holy Ghost is here present right now. It's right there in front of you. But you can't grab it with your head. And that's the way that that's the way you've been taught. That's the only thing you know, how to grab things with your head, how to figure it out with your mind. You're always making these decisions about things that really have no value. I want to set before you something that is so awesome. And it's supposed to define us of who we are. In Acts chapter 26 and verse 18, it's supposed to define who we are. That the Lord Himself, this is the heavenly vision, that the Lord Himself has given us the power to open up the eyes of the blind, amen, to turn people from darkness to light, from the power of Satan to the power of God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance with all of the saints in light. Now, I want you to understand this. This works for your family. It works for your parents and your children. It works for your extended family, for your relatives, for the people that are at work. It is a place and a position in God that you can't have just because you say, well, I believe that that's the Bible, and that's what the Bible says, so I'm going to go around and I'm going to start saying these things. It ain't going to work that way. There is an event in your life, first and foremost, where you've got to be born again. And then there's an event in your life where all of a sudden you recognize the wonderful thing that God did when he made you a new creation, and now you become consecrated to that. To say, wow, I belong to heaven. I belong to heaven. Oh, wow, I really don't even know what to do. I need to be taught. Great moment of breakthrough. A great moment. I've got to be different than the way I was before I was born again. What a revelation. And I'm just waiting for all God's people to get that one. I'm going to have to be different than what I was before. The former conversation has passed away. The old creature no longer exists. The old man is crucified. I'm going to be taught now of God. I need to be taught of God. How is that going to happen? Praise the Lord for the church. Amen. You weren't here this morning. I want you to get quickly the YouTube and watch the YouTube. And thank you, Chrissy, for sending out the email to let everybody know here how they can immediately watch the replay in the morning of the web. And, you know, it's just so important for you to decide, I'm not missing out on the things that God has for me. And especially if you want to be or participating in any way of any kind of leadership in here, we don't want you doing your stuff. We want you doing our stuff. Huh? Our stuff, I'm talking about Papa God, the Lord Jesus Christ and the Holy Ghost as he's given it to us and it's flowing out to you. We don't want you off, basically cutting cross grain to Jesus and to the plan of God. And so you're going to have to get in pace with what's going on. You're going to have to get in step with what's going on. Hallelujah. And you should really want to, because really the value of it, what the importance of it is that we're set on seeing a company of people raised up to walk with God fully in every way, in obedience to him and in submission to him, so that he can have his way with us. You know, I'll just tell you like it is. I really believe that there is a lot of folks who've taken a hold of things that look like God, and it's not God, and their life isn't consecrated, and then ultimately what happens is people go following after them, and then they've got a wrong model, and they start then giving place to compromises in their life, and once again, it's just running ruin in the church. The ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ comes out of the kind of consecration that Christ Jesus displayed for us. Hello. One amen, three smiles, five nods, and 60 silent people. We just want you to participate a little bit more here.
Yes.
If you could just grab a hold of the gift of faith.
Yes.
If there was just something going on in your life that would cause you to be shocked at the reality that you're about ready to step over into eternity, and what have you done? I'm going to go tomorrow, and you know, I have purpose in my heart to raise a preacher from the dead. But I'm going to tell you right now, you listen to me. He stepped over full. He stepped over full. Because there was not one person that he didn't bring to a decision about Jesus Christ. There's not one opportunity in the kingdom of God that he didn't drop everything and just run wide open. I mean, drop everything. And when I'm talking about drop everything, it would cost tens of thousands of dollars a day for him to drop everything and go do it. And he had no connection to him. Think about it. When you step over, you're about to bust through the barrier. You're about to break through the barrier. What are you doing? What do you stand there with? Do you stand before the Lord Jesus with a half-consecrated heart to him? Do you stand there before the Lord Jesus Christ with a balance where it's plain that you've lived your life for you more than you've lived your life for him? See, if I can just bring people to the moment of shock, then somehow we might begin to start moving once again in the kinds of revival passion that happened in the church long ago that resulted in the fire and the glory of God being revealed and manifested on the earth. We're talking about people who were so desperate for God and so hungry for God because the reality of their need was apparent before them. They weren't all fixated on the earth and consumed with earthly and worldly interest. The world, your worldliness in your life will put out every fire that the Holy Ghost starts. Let me just tell you that. The worldliness in your life will make you passionateless and lukewarm for the things of God. You won't have any fire in your belly. It's because of the worldliness. All you got to do is get quiet long enough with the Lord, and He'll show you your worldliness, your compromises with sin and the devil, your compromises with all the offense and all of the ridiculous nonsense that plays in your mind where it exalts you above the interest of Jesus. It's true. And Father's just looking for people who He can empower and give such authority to that they, everywhere they go, they don't really have to make altar calls in so much, in so many words. What they have is a power resident in them to turn, to open up the eyes of the blind.
Amen.
To turn people from darkness to light. Just the encounter with the encountering you is encountering the very presence of the living God.
Amen.
Are you interested in
yes.
that? Then all you have to do is seek the Lord. And He will rain down upon you. See, Father is waiting and longing to bring forth a precious fruit of the earth. There's a precious fruit of the earth that James says it like this. He says, brethren, have patience unto the coming of the Lord Jesus. In James chapter 5, he said, because Father's waiting for the precious fruit of the earth to come forth. And the precious fruit of the earth that He's purposed to come forth is this witness that He wants displayed of His glory and of His power through you and me. The precious fruit of the earth isn't just the bringing in of the lost. The precious fruit of the earth is where we begin to live the heavenly life in the earthly realm. Come on now. Let me walk you through a couple of verses of Scripture, then I'll bring you back here. Look at Acts 2:22. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Acts 2:22 says, Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God among you by miracles and wonders and signs. That's the life of Jesus. And he's beckoned for all of us to come follow Him. And when we want to respond to that, I'm going to tell you right now, that's a major transition. What all are you not going to do that Father asked you to do to come follow Jesus? And what are you going to do with that alternate plan and those other things that the enemy of your soul would harass your mind with and try to deceive you and make it look so good to you that you just can't seem to find that kind of commitment to the Lord? Listen to me. I'm talking about where you're living. I'm talking about the crisis of your choices. Yeah, you know, when the things begin to get devastating in the United States of America, as they are going to be in the whole world, then everybody, you know, when you don't have food and you don't have a job and you don't have all these other things and there's war going on around you and bullets are going off everywhere and there's total upheaval, yeah, you're going to be crying out to God. But you know, it's not really much of a time to advance the move of the Spirit. And it took a crisis, but you know what? As soon as that crisis is removed, you'd be right back to doing what you're doing now if it's different from what God's called you to do. Because it's been proven over and over again. Oh, the men would praise the Lord for His wonderful works to us, the children of men. The psalm just talks about it. How the Lord came and moved by His Spirit and delivered them. And as soon as He did, they were back doing whatever it was they were doing. Then He gave them over to their enemies. And then they cried out in the midst of their disaster, and He came and delivered them again. Father is easy. You know how easy Father is? Look at Nineveh. Nineveh, one of the most wicked cities that ever existed. If not the most wicked city that have ever existed. And Jonah goes to them and says, repent. And they repented. And they fasted. And they made their animals fast too. And the Lord forgave them. Because he's so merciful. And he revived them. Because they had come to a point that if it goes any more, if it gets any worse, if they make another turn in the road, they're beyond all hope. They're at the point of beyond all hope of being redeemable or salvageable, if you would. And they did the right thing. How easy is it for you and I to begin to step over into a place where the plan for our life is to follow in Jesus' footstep and walk in his ministry and do what he did and be this person in ministry that is described right here in Acts 2:22. The Jesus of Nazareth, how that God anointed Jesus of Nazareth, the man. How that God bore witness of Jesus of Nazareth, the man. Think about Jesus, God bearing witness of Jesus of Nazareth, the man, for just a minute here. Look at this. Look at him being approved of God. Look at Father, in other words, bearing witness of him. Does Jesus need to have someone bearing witness of him right now? Is there a need for a sobering encounter with the power of God in the land right now? And not just so spotty that you've got to get a magnifying glass out to find out when it happened. And it's just so rare that it's easy to forget. Now, with this many people sitting in here, there ought to be signs and wonders and miracles happening all over San Diego and Southern California so much that that CNN has to pay attention to it because it's too big. Amen. The problem is we're happy with our own lives. We're happy with our stupid stuff. SS. Our stupid stuff. That when you measure it in eternity, it's actually worse than stupid stuff. When you measure it in the view of what you and I are going to have to stand before the Lord Jesus Christ on that day, I'm going to tell you right now. I love him, I want to be with him, but I don't want to go right now because I haven't done enough. I haven't lived fully enough. And I'm going to make sure by this time next year that I've lived fully enough. I'm going to make sure. I mean, I'm not going to continue on, because what's going to happen to you is you are in a rut. You are in a ditch. You are in a process of the way that you've been doing things, and there's no way out for you but a radical encounter with God. And that's probably not going to happen till you get so desperate that you'll do anything. Amen. To have that encounter. All your models around you are telling you to turn the other way. And many of you are right down in the middle of so much demonic stuff that it's almost impossible for you to get any footing and make any progression forward, because your parents don't have enough sense to get you out of that mess. And I'm sorry, but it's just the way it is. And some of you, you don't even have parents anymore because you're the parents and you've got yourself in a big crisis and a big pile of mess. Are you listening to me? And you don't know how to get out. Well, all you got to do is call upon the name of the Lord and he'll get you out. Amen. And he's going to tell you to change. And he's going to tell you to do things differently. He's going to tell you, listen. He's going to tell you to listen to your pastor. He's going to tell you to listen to the gifting that he placed in the church for you to be perfected, for you to be built up, for you to be established. Amen. I pray that each one of you going into 2016, that there's not a single person in here that somehow is not going to fully participate with ministry. That there's not going to be some kind of attitude and some kind a disposition in your life that you're going to walk away from God's means of perfecting you, walk away from God's means of establishing you, walk away from God's means of protecting you, because you just never really responded to the call of God upon your life. I'm believing tonight that you're going to respond. Yes. And I know the battle, because you know what? Deception doesn't have any reason to it, and it can't see past its nose. It just can't. And so we can be talking to people, and they just feel like, well, it doesn't apply to me. No, listen, this is where you're going to have to get alone with God and begin to listen to heaven, because if you'll get alone with God, if you'll shut everything else out that you've been filling yourself full of, all of a sudden you will listen to what's going on inside of you, and it's going to scare you. You're going, no, you'll say, no wonder. No wonder there's been a limitation on how much God can use me. Look at what's going on in my head. That's why people keep stuff on all the time. They've always got something going on. And then they fall exhausted in the bed so they don't ever have to listen to what's going on in their head. Hello. The Lord's calling us ever into another realm. He's calling us into a place of walking just like he walked, with the same signs, wonders, and miracles. Because no one is ever going to, this society is not going to be changed. The people around you are not going to be impacted until signs, wonders, and miracles. And the life and the purity and the glory and all the rest. We want signs, wonders, and miracles without the glory and the purity. Huh? They got all these various different mixtures, these different hybrids that they want. Father's looking for some people that are going to be willing to imitate Christ Jesus and be conformed to Christ Jesus. Amen. In every area, from A to Z, from purity to wonders. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Look in Acts chapter 3, Acts chapter 4, verse 33. Acts chapter 4, verse 33. The Lord says that with great power, the apostles gave witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, people say, do I really need the baptism of the Holy Ghost? Is it really essential? Yeah, because the Lord wants to make you a witness. He says, and you can't be a witness of my resurrection until you're endued with power from on high. Guess what happens to you once you've been endued with power from on high? You can give great witness with signs and wonders. There's a miracle working power at work in your life. If you're willing to be developed by God, if you're willing to be developed by the way and means by which he designed for his people to now be taught of him. There's so many people that I really truly believe that it is in their heart to fully walk with God and serve God, but they're not willing to do it God's way. They're not willing to be truly taught of God. They want to be kind of taught of God. What they're going to do is they're going to listen and they're going to read, but they're going to decide at the end of the process what they agree with and what they disagree with. And you're never going to get anywhere. They say, so how's it been working out for you up to this point? Is it real slow progress? Is it snail or sloth progress? Are you listening to me? Come on, think about it. I mean, where are you going? Is it a slow road to the future in Christ Jesus that you're on? Or is it the King's highway? Is it expedited? Because he said, I sent the Holy Ghost to expedite this thing. Lots to break through here tonight. Because I'm dealing with your life. I'm dealing with your decisions. I'm dealing with your choices. And I'm telling you, you got to change. I'm telling you, everything about your life has got to change. And that's hard going right there. It's hard going. I'm telling you that you're going to have to rend your hearts and not your garments. I'm telling you that you're going to really have to begin to seek the Lord. I'm telling you, you're going to have to really begin to weigh the choices of whether or not you're going to be what everybody's tried to define you to be, or whether you're going to step over into this glorious opportunity. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Tako dane este pradopa de estika tulomo shipaya. Batak ane ixtitolahosh. Hare desi tu frataya. Hallelujah. 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 Sizuranas de devre de candos de brete shia. Hale bondere shita bukane e shiponre nande pi anda saya. Hallelujah. Brandazarana isheya. Is de brinando bojiju shane e kia. Is de rijando la de jica tu rigina da paturi. Malandane de be este prete kivriti. Manandere de shiprodost. I'm not talking about just having moments of feeling good about the presence of the Lord. I'm talking about your life being consumed with the fire of God. Amen. I'm talking about your life being consumed with the presence of the living God. I mean, you've had just a little taste. Every person in here, you've had a little taste. It should have got you really thirsty for all that he has for you. It's just this encounter. What Father wants to do is just so right here. It's so right in front of us. It's so right is available. You can lay hold. Hallelujah. The outworking. I've got the Holy Ghost. It's right here, right now. It's available. Yes. The manifestation of the Spirit, yes. The gift of faith, the gifts of healing, the working of miracles, available right now, right where you're at. An encounter with God, God, the Holy Spirit, hovering over your life right now. So you say, well, okay, I'm ready already. Nah, there's some barriers. Huh? There's some barriers. There's some places that you're not allowing God to have free access. Father, you can have every room in the house but the living room. Living room is mine. It's off. And you can have every room in the house, but don't come into the living room. Because we got some stuff going on in there that you're just not going to be happy with, and we're going to feel uncomfortable if you're in there while we're doing it. The gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ is laid down for us in the New Testament. It describes to us exactly how he wants his gospel preached, describes to us exactly what we're supposed to do and how we're supposed to live, and how he's going to develop us, and so therefore we can understand exactly what we need to do to participate. Everyone's without excuse. Father has given us everything that we have need of. He's given us everything that we need. According to his divine power, he has given to us everything that we have need of. According to his divine power, he's given to us everything that we have need of. But when you're distracted with other things, it's not going to have its full effect and not going to result in that outworking. Now in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I command you to be strengthened by the Spirit of the Lord. Right now in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I command you to be able to see with the insight of heaven, that your eyes would be open, that you may be able to understand what's going on. Hallelujah. What Papa's purpose to do with your life. And that you'll be able to see it on such a scale that you get excited about it and you want it more than anything else. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Let's go to Acts 6:8. I believe it's Acts 6:8. We'll get over there. We'll see it. Yes, it's 6:8. Here's just your average Christian. Your average, everyday, ordinary Christian, full of the Holy Ghost, been baptized in the Holy Ghost. There's a lot of folks running around saying they've been baptized in the Holy Ghost. You may have been baptized in the Holy Ghost, but the grace of God was poured out on you in vain because you're not going and doing anything with it. Hello. Something happened about the seek. Something got broken down in the seeking process. Something got broken down in the obedience process. Something got broken down in moving forward with God process. And the beautiful thing of it is Father always gives us an opportunity to, in any moment, at any time, at any day, to start over with him. Just to repent and say, okay, Father, I've been doing it wrong. Forgive me. I want to get it right. And we can just get right back on track with the Lord. But somehow that's fuzzy. Somehow we don't get it. We don't look at the fact that there's not a lot of demonstration of power of God in my life. In fact, I sit around over here oppressed with the devil more than anything else. I'll beat myself up in shame and guilt and all these problems. That isn't the redeemed life. Amen. All hungry and thirsty for some more sin and iniquity and some more entertainment and some more worldliness. Listen, that's not the appetites of the Holy Ghost. Now you're being fashioned and formed in something that is totally contrary to everything that God is. It's going to be very difficult for you to receive anything from the Holy Ghost. Hello? I'm talking to people here tonight that are going to have to make a choice about whether or not they're going to live the life in 2016 the way that they've lived it up to this point. This is a great time, a great opportunity for people to get right with God, get consecrated to the Lord, and say, Lord, I'm no more for half measures. I've decided I'm just going to go ahead and live in heaven. I've decided that I'm going to go ahead and live this life that I no longer live. It's you that lives, Jesus. I'm going to have everything being conformed to your image and formed to your will. Well, if you're just willing to do it, then God the Holy Spirit will move in with all the resources of heaven and empower you to do these things. Hallelujah. It's just really that simple. Suddenly you say, Father, I'm tired of the powerlessness of my life. I'm tired of not being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God. I'm tired of being barren in some people's instance. Father, somehow I've never really had a burden for the lost, and I know now because I've suddenly had an encounter that that is an oppressive demon spirit that I've allowed in my life. That is because I am been drinking the poison of the world, and that's why I have no burden for the lost. I have no real ability to get hungry and thirsty for all the things that you have given me an opportunity to do because I'm so convoluted, I'm so conflicted about all the stuff that I want to do that belongs to a temporal life. See, this is the process. Scary, isn't it? I don't blame you for being quiet on that one. But you really should have gone ahead and give it a roar out of it. Like, yeah, it is. Because I'm telling you right now, people, God ain't coming up short on this program. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
We're the ones coming up short on the program. God's not coming up short. We're not the ones that are not seeking Him. We're the ones that are not drawing nigh to Him. He's ready to draw nigh to those who draw nigh to Him. He's ready to respond to those who seek Him earnestly.
Amen.
Yeah, that's the way it is. I'm going to tell you, everything that you can acquire in this life is going to absolutely have no meaning for you any moment that you stand before the presence of the Lord. Any encounter with God, that all that is profane to you and a distraction and that which has consumed your life and wasted your life. I just want you to be able to have that encounter tonight. I'm preaching so that you can have that encounter. I'm declaring these things that you can have then this encounter tonight. But if you get all of a sudden begin to build a wall because I don't know what I'm talking about or it's just too hard or I don't understand, God don't understand, then there's no change ever going to happen. There's no empowerment ever going to take place. There's no encounter that is going to be the result. The preaching is not going to be effective in your life. And I know what? I know this preaching that I'm preaching right now is going to be effective in your life. You watch what happens. You might be yawning now, but just wait till you see what happens before this thing is over. Amen. You might be, some people start fasting and they're like, slow motion. Everything you can. It's good for you. Good for you. It's good for you. Good for you. Hallelujah. Sutaramangitaya. Lipandorosipet. Starts paring things down. Hallelujah. Sutande belina makashi pruno safatilo. Hallelujah. Ramomba dekina mashe. God's real. He's real.
Amen.
He's here.
Yes.
Everything that He's been doing and said that He would do, He's never stopped doing.
Yep.
He's never given up. He's just looking. What Father is going to do is going to, by and large, be expressed through some human being. And people want it expressed some other way. They want Him to just come down and do it so everybody can stand there going, "Ooh, great, praise God, I didn't have to work or do anything for this. I just got it all for free. This was a great moment of entertainment. Now I'm back to whatever it was I was doing before." It's happened over and again. It's the crisis of the Bible over and again. People see the glory of God, and that's exactly what was their response. Father has set it up right now that all the glory and all the power and all the manifestation of His Spirit, by and large, are going to happen through people like you and me who are willing to allow Him to flow through our lives, where we're willing to allow Him to take us to a place that we can represent Him.
Amen.
And represent Him on a level. And that, as we describe in Acts chapter 26 and verse 18, and it's not like it hasn't already had witness even in recent days. You don't have to go all the way back to the days of the Bible. In recent days, such events have happened. And we don't even have to go back as far as Charles Finney, but Charles Finney is a great example. We don't have to go back as far as Smith Wigglesworth, but he's a great example. But you probably can't really find an example after the 50s. There's probably not an example of this after the 50s. To have that kind of an encounter with God, to have that kind of a presence and a communication of the Spirit of the Lord in your life, where people have an encounter with the Lord when they encounter you and they're turned from, their eyes are open, they're no more spiritually blind, they turn from darkness to light and from the power of Satan to God by the encounter. That's the authority that God has given to us. We can say, look, the whole world lies in darkness. The whole world lies under a power of the satanic. They lie under this darkness and this love for all the stuff that of the modern age. Look, you and I are supposed to be vested with an authority that just completely annihilates that. It nullifies it. It completely demolishes it. And not just diminish it. It decimates it. That's the best word. Now what happens is we can sit around and we could go, oh, well, that's true. That's what the Bible says. But man, that sounds like a lot of change for me. What do I got to do? And I might start saying, well, you need to start fasting and praying. Or you need to start giving yourself over to seeking the Lord and giving yourself to every church meeting and giving yourself to a greater time of just waiting upon the Lord, waiting upon the Lord in prayer. Does miracle changes? Giving yourself to the Word of God does more than what you can retain with your memory. It's a miracle working power. And all of a sudden, that now demands that everything about your life that you become comfortable with has to be changed, because now you're used to getting off work and maybe you're going to the gym or you're going to do this or you're going to go do that. You're playing pinochle or whatever it is that you do, or you're watching, you know, television, and you sit there and you watch television until you fall asleep and drool all over yourself or whatever. And that's the routine. That's the cycle. And then we get you back here at church meeting, and we're basically having to start from square one. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Well, why don't you break that cycle? Why don't you say, you know what? You know, I believe that it would be better to seek God than being entertained. And then when we think about the source of the entertainment is coming from, it's right out of the demonic strategy to make sure that you have no sensitivity to the Holy Ghost. Hello? And if we could just wake up for just a few minutes, you mean, you're telling me, what are you telling me now? I'm inviting you into the realms of majesty and glory. I'm inviting you over into a place where the demonstration of the power and the glory of God might be seen in your way and in your life in an entirely different dimension and way, an entirely different dimension of faith. Can you imagine what would happen to this world if the gift of faith was allowed to operate in everybody that is sitting in here? The gift of faith that operates on the level of a consecrated life to those people who are set to doing it God's way, not just partially, all the way God's way. My. What a wonderful day that would be. You know, the Jewish leaders were right. If they left Jesus alone, all the world would be turned to him. There'd be nobody walking after the Mosaic law anymore. They're all going to get saved. If Jesus stays here, they're all going to get saved. Jesus had a great plan. I'm going to reproduce myself and my people.
Amen.
But yet there's been a problem. There's been a delay. There's been a new display of what's right, a new model, a new demonic strategy of religion working in the midst of Christianity to keep people from moving forward, to get them engulfed in worldliness, to get them engulfed in the cares of this earth. It's a claw. It's a hook from hell. And the beautiful, wonderful good news of it all is all you got to do is call upon the Lord and get real serious about him. Say, I don't want that hook no more. I don't want to be conflicted anymore. I want to live completely and totally for you. I want to understand how to simply leave this earthly realm and step over into the heavenly. I want to simply understand, Lord, what I need to do to find my life having the expression where I am not in any way under the yoke of any hindrance or resistance that Satan could run against my life, because you delivered me from the power of darkness and you translated me over to the kingdom of your Son. And I want to learn how to live over here in the light and walk in the light. I want to learn how to walk as the salt. I want to learn how to walk out this wonderful ministry of Jesus Christ that stands between the dead and the living. And I'm not going to preach that sermon again this evening, but this morning I preached a sermon I want you to hear about the standing between the dead and the living, and understanding that the church is exactly that. And one day, in the not too distant future, the church is going to be removed. And I'm going to tell you, it's going to be hell on earth, because there will be an unrestrained wickedness. There'll be an unrestrained mystery of iniquity revealed. I've recently written this book because I want people to read it and get scared to death.
Amen.
I had a preacher that I've asked to write a foreword for me. He said, I'm going to tell you, I read the book. He said, the integrity of it is amazing, because you did not depart at all from the scripture. You laid it out there. He said, but after I was finished reading, I sat numb. I was just numb, saying, is there any hope for humanity?
Right.
And so he said, could you please go in there and give us just a little bit of hope?
Yeah.
So I went back and I put in some paragraphs, basically calls to repentance, calls to take a hold of God, calls to come out from among her, calls to escape the wrath that is to come, calls to recognize that all this time, Father in his mercy has been calling out to men when men turn away from him and walk in sin and are taught of the devil and his angels how to do more perversely, yet God's still pleading with men. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Still pleading. And he's pleading now. He's looking for some people to go all the way with him. People, you're going to have to understand. You're going to have to get, there needs to be a revival fire like a Josiah in your spirit. Josiah is one of the greatest examples of revival in the Old Testament. Look at what he did. I mean, you know, Solomon had built a high place to the goddess Ashtart, which is very similar to your Starbucks, guys, that you guys go sip and drink under her banner. But nonetheless, that's another issue. I'm not going to talk about that. But built an image to the mother of harlots, because that's who she is. And that high place was never taken down. People were still ensnared by that high place under the days of Josiah. Josiah got a flame torch and went around killing everything, destroying it all. He got himself an axe. He got himself a sword, and he went around destroying everything that was in their lives that was a part of the perverse world system.
Amen.
Revival.
Amen.
Revival. Revival. I don't believe people know how to define worldliness anymore. I don't believe they know how to define it. I don't think they spend enough time in prayer to define worldliness. I don't think they spend enough time in the Word of God to define worldliness. God has defined it worldliness. He says, all that is in the world. I'm going to tell you, everything that is not the fires of the Holy Ghost and the ministry of the Holy Spirit is worldliness. It's just the world. And I'm going to tell you, it is an enemy of God, and you're supposed to be cut off from it. It's supposed to be crucified to you, not something that you delight in or entertain by. It's supposed to be crucified to us, and we're supposed to be crucified to it. And we've opened the door to allow too much compromise in. And in that, through that, we've opened up the door of compromise to allow too much influence of the satanic in, and we don't even realize it because it's common and it's ordinary. And I'm telling you right now, the cup continually gets filled with subtle strategies and suggestions and then blasphemies. And people now have to sit and listen to programs, and they do it that have cussing all the way through it. It's just one foul word after another. And I'm going to tell you right now, I don't care how much you stuff up your ears. It's in your belly. It's in your belly. It's in your belly. It's in your belly. A guy was telling me recently about a preacher who died, and while he was on his deathbed, half the time he was praising the Lord, and the other half the time he was cussing God and everybody else out. He was out of his mind. You know, he was in that transition period. What was on the inside of him was coming out, his compromised life. And it was horrific, the things that were being said. But I'm just telling you, it gets in you. You just think that it's okay. You think it's harmless. It's not harmless. It's polluting you. It's vexing your righteous soul with the filthy conversation of the wicked. Far worse than what Lot experienced in Sodom and Gomorrah. Far worse. Far worse. I'm telling you, far worse. It's about time, dear people, that we're going to... So I said, oh, he's just talking about medieval holiness now. I'm talking about walking with God. I'm talking about separating yourself from the things that are in this world and start walking out a heavenly life. I'm telling you, it's far better than what Satan has deceived you to believe that you can get out of the pleasures of this world. I'm telling you, walking over in a heavenly realm is far more glorious. It's far more full of pleasures. And everything that Satan can do is to work to hide that so that you'll never understand that, so that you won't live it out, because he has no hope of stopping you and the effectiveness that you'll have in God when you come out from among her, huh? You come out from her midst, huh? A Babylonian system, a worldly system. You come out from her, hallelujah, and you're separated unto God, and you're willing to now live for him in such a way that you touch not the unclean thing.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Father, we thank you that in the midst of this place, you're going to have a people that are going to live for you. They're going to say no to a life of demonic realm, no to a life of this world, no to a life of sin, no to a life of ungodliness. And they're going to say, Father, you got me. You changed me. You've washed me in your blood. You've given me your Holy Spirit. And now I'm going to give all of my attention and all of my affections to learning how to walk exactly like you want me to walk, to being built up and strengthened. My goodness, you just think about what Enoch's going to be like when he steps on this earth. He's been standing in the presence of God for 5,000 years. You talk about being sent out of the presence of the Lord. You're talking about being full of faith and a fiery, holy indignation. He was already prophesying God's coming with 10,000s of his saints to execute judgment upon all the ungodly, for their ungodly deeds would save ungodly committed. Imagine what he's going to look like when he stands on the earth in the very near future. And Elijah's standing there right beside of him. They're partners in it. And Elijah's been standing there in the presence of the Lord for almost 2,700 years. But lost up to tell you. I'm going to tell you right now, dear people, you and I can come and stand in the presence of the Lord, and we can minister before the presence of the Lord, and we can be sent out with similar kinds of thunders and similar kinds of lightnings and similar kinds of fiery streams proceeding forth from our midst. I'm telling you right now, if that's not exciting to you, I can't tell you anymore, because that is it. God has given us a privilege of standing with him in a heavenly realm and breaking every power of darkness and every stronghold of hell upon people's life. But it's got to be broken off our life first. There can't be any place to the powers of darkness. There can't be any fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness. The result is a glorious ministry of love and grace. Hallelujah. But it's a glorious ministry also of faith and judgment. And I was talking to a preacher in Australia this afternoon, and he was asking me some different questions about things. And I said, but look, the reality of it is, it's no one standing up and making it known that God burns and has a stored up wrath against sin and iniquity. And thus, because no one's preaching messages like, if the righteous scarcely be saved, where shall sinners stand in the day of judgment? No one's standing up and declaring, flee from the wrath of God, and then making known the display of his wrath upon sin and iniquity, how he's held it back. No one's preaching that he stored up the fraud, he stored up the snow and the hail and all of these other things that are described in Job chapter 38, that this is a day that God's going to pour out without any restraint his judgment on sin and iniquity. No one is telling or talking about the fact that people are going to be cast alive into the lake of fire, that everyone who refused to walk with him is going to spend an eternity in the lake of fire, that their smoke of their torment ascends up before the Lamb and before the throne of God for eternity. Nobody's saying anything about this. Just all of these things about making you feel good and all about God's love and grace that really is actually causing people to justify sin. And there's no fear of God before them. When there's no fear of God, then tell me, how can there ever be a conviction of the Holy Ghost? 50 years ago, Men would be reverential towards prayer. 70 years ago, my goodness, the most heathen man would have stopped and give great respect to a minister of the gospel. Doesn't exist anymore. People talking about a great awakening. People talking about revival. Good. But there needs to be the message of repent and flee from the wrath that is to come. It needs to be on the level of how God brought it down and said, listen, you got to understand what you're doing is absolutely cursed. What you're doing is absolutely nothing less than a target of the full judgments of God unleashed upon your life. We're never going to really understand these things nor participate with these things until we're willing to come get separate with the Lord. We're willing to come get along with God. We're willing to be taught of the Lord. We're going to be under the angelic power of a demon spirit, an angelic host and power that's called humanism. Humanism can justify every wrong and make every evil thing acceptable and understandable. And every false thing logical. And every person becomes right in their own eyes. And people out of that realm, totally given over to that realm, hate any concept of a God of wrath. And just as much as he is a God of love, he's a God of wrath. Yeah. Just as much as he's a God of grace, he's a God and mercy, he's a God of judgment. And there's something that's got to happen to our lives to where we can begin to see this. We've got to have an encounter where we can see it, because out of that's going to come a great burden for the lost. And it's not only going to work within our life. Such righteous indignation, such separation, such obedience. But it's going to cause us to recognize people are under the yoke of a demonic power. And it needs to be broken. There's no hope. There's no logical reasoning with them that is going to change that situation. It is going to be an encounter with the presence of the living God. It's going to be an encounter with an anointing, an authority that God gives to people who are willing to be not only a recipient of all this glory and all this authority, but people that are obedient children, people that are fashioned after him rather than fashioned after the world. You can't have compromises with the world and this authority too. Maybe there's things that you've got to unplug in your life. Do it. Maybe there's friendships and relationships that you need to cut off. Cut them off. Get yourself over in the presence of the Lord, living in the fire of God. And then when everything about your life is in order and you're strengthened by the authority of the Lord, then you can go back to them and hopefully bring them out of their ditch. Bring them out of their sin and their iniquity. Look, Father needs a witness. Jesus needs a witness. Who is Jesus? Jesus' ministry is all about what I read to you in Acts chapter 22. It's going about doing signs and wonders and miracles, displaying the power and the glory of God, an authority over every satanic realm. What is the ministry all about of those who follow him? Once again, it's about signs and wonders and demonstration of the power of God, so that the gospel is advanced in such a way that in less than 30 years, it's almost like the whole known world was reached. It's almost every power of darkness that had dominated men's mind was brought down in a generation. The city like Ephesus that worshiped Ishtar, or who we call another name for is Easter, or which some people want to hear that, but it's just true, and many other names. But they're called in Ephesus Diana or Artemis. She was worshipped for the whole history since the conception of that city. But by the preaching of Paul, her stronghold was brought down. Her power was no longer. Everyone was completely delivered from her spell. Amen. Yeah. Right now, people need to be delivered from the spell of every immoral thing in the realms of licentious and unbridled lust. It's a spell that is over men's mind. It's a lasciviousness that is over people's lives. Satan knows that there is no way more effective to corrupt and destroy the soul and the morality of man and the image of God and bring them more into a cursed state than through those kinds of things. And they are pervasive, and people are trapped in them, being the stronghold of them. And it's about time God's people rise up with an authority to break off that yoke, that demon spirit that would be fully manifested to those who are under its spell. And they recognize that this goes beyond all the things that psychologists say and sociologists say. This is a demon power whose purpose is to destroy your soul in hell for eternity. We've got to move past all of this need of discussing the things of choices about worldliness and choices about sin and choices about disobedience, and just start talking about all the realms of the things that the Holy Ghost would reveal to us about how to cooperate with the gift of faith and move in the working of miracles and have the word of knowledge and develop the discerning of spirits. But so much we have to just talk about the continual choices that people are making. When you should not have a choice. The world should be crucified to you. You should be crucified to the world. You shouldn't even have a choice. Amen. You gave your will over to the Father to do the will of the Father. You don't have a will no more. Amen. Hallelujah. You voluntarily gave your will over. Hallelujah. What's wrong with you? You need to unplug things in your life is what you need to do. You need to bring down the high places of your life. Where you've gone and you've given your affections to other things. You've participated with other spirits. To where they become now no more adulterous, but virtuous to the Lord. No longer committing spiritual adultery. No longer giving your mind over to demonic thoughts of divisions and strife and emulations and offenses and all the rest of the mess. But recognizing what it is, recognizing what it is, and saying, no, I'm not having any place in it. I'm not having any place in my life. And being so earnest about it that you desperately cry out to God, oh, God, help me. You run to him for safety like somebody's trying to kill you. Because really, it is on that level. It really is. The wages of sin is death. These things would bring our lives into bondage and destroy our soul forever. Somebody said, is a loving God going to really be that kind of a God of judgment? Absolutely, and I'm so blessed for it. Otherwise, heaven would be hell. Because as long as this stuff keeps going on, it's going to, you know what? The same results. And watch out, because I'm going to tell you what's going on, and the pot's being stirred right now. A great world war is about to take place. Yeah. People say it can't happen. It's going to happen. It's going to be worse than the 54 million people that died in World War II. And it's going to happen right here. Right here on our home turf. And it's just a sad reality. It's a sad reality, people. Ruth Ann recently had a vision, and she saw the Lincoln Memorial Monument split in half and a great darkness move into the White House. There's a number of prophets that prophesied these things. William Branham, sitting in 1933, prophesied what's going on right now, and the consequences were pretty radical. You listen to me. It was pretty radical. Pretty radical. He described where women would cut their hair and wear clothes like men in 1933. And other things that help us literally clearly see what's going on in this time period. Because in his time period, 1933, there wasn't anywhere to see. You could see that. Didn't exist. Wasn't a part of society. And if you think we've advanced, we've degenerated. Yeah. We're not advanced nowhere. Right. We've not moved forward. We've moved back. We've become more like hell than heaven. Heaven is an advancement. Right. Huh? All civilization is defined by preachers who went to places that were complete in chaos and upheaval and brought the gospel, and it brought civilization. Yeah. Hallelujah. Because some form of heaven was brought. Right. Praise God. Listen to me. You know, I was reminded of a story not too long ago because of so many things that have happened. And I was telling somebody about this story the other day, because God did great exploits through William Branham. And And it doesn't matter what doctrines he was preaching. God did great exploits to William Branham. He was radical about certain things. And it was all geared towards holiness and consecration. But he was radical about it, and it was off to a lot of people. So he got a bad rap at the end. But he was in a meeting one night, and there was this girl. She was terribly sick, terribly diseased. She was paralyzed, had all kinds of problems. She was barely even here. And he said, well, this girl's going to be, she was beyond all repair, beyond anything that physicians could do. And those are the kinds of cases over and over again that we saw the power of God change through his life and through ministers' lives like him back in the 40s. And we need to see it again. Amen. And is it going to be a consecrated life? You want to have their results, get their consecration, because that's just the way it is. You want to have a Wiss Smith Wigglesworth life, get his consecration. You want to have a John G. Lake life, get his consecration. Because I'm going to tell you, this manifestation of authority comes by way of the consecration. And that's just all there is to it. And it's not earned, it's received. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's just a state and a place to be and to receive it. But at any rate, let me just tell you the story. Because that night, she didn't get healed. And William Branham had just gone through some conflict where Gordon Lindsay had set up this meeting with all these pastors, and they were going to drill into him about his doctrines and whatnot. And so he didn't want to go to it, and Gordon Lindsay said, no, you really need to, man. These guys can just, you know, they can really hurt the ministry. And So he decides to go. He said, okay, I'm going to go, but I'm going to tell you right now, the venue that they've already got is not going to be there. It's going to be over here at this other place, and this is the address, and I'm going to tell you who's going to be sitting on the platform, and he gave each one of their names. And he said, and who's here is going to be sitting on the front row, and he gave all of their names. And so Gordon Lindsay, I believe it was Gordon Lindsay, it was either Gordon or it was Tommy Hicks, one of the two, just went to him and said, you know what, he just gave him just a little brief interim information. The leaders of this thing. He said, William Branham said he's going to come. He said, but it's not going to be at the venue that you guys got. And the person kind of chuckled and said, no, it's locked down. It's ours. We've already paid for it. It's going to be there. Just don't let anybody, I don't want any confusion. It's going to be at that address. Well, by that evening, he gets a shock report that something has happened. The venue's not available. It's not going to be there. So what happens now, he's got to go find another venue. And you know where that other venue was. It's just exactly addressed it. Did William Branham had said. And so ultimately, this is a great story, because now he goes there and he's going to get drilled by all of these, you know, several hundred preachers. And so Gordon Lindsay or Tommy X, whichever one it was, stood up and said, okay, guys, I know that you guys got a bunch of questions. I know that you guys got some serious issues, but let me just help set the atmosphere right. First of all, William Branham told me that the venue you guys had wasn't going to work and you were going to actually be right here at this address. I am a witness to it. And then he turned and he pointed each person. He said their name. He said, you would be sitting there. And he said, Tom, you'd be sitting there. And James, you'd be sitting there. And, you know, Roger, you'd be sitting there. He went down to every one of their names. And he laid it all out there. And he says, now, in this context, I'm going to have William Branham come up and talk to you. And you can ask him questions. And William Branham got up and he stood at the platform and he said this to all the preachers. He said, okay, I tell you what. You may come and ask me any questions you want. I'm happy to answer them, but you got to come stand right here by my side. And everybody knew what William Branham had said over and over again, that the angel of the Lord was by his side. And no one took him up on it. Very smart, very wise preachers with all their questions. Do I agree with the things that William Branham was saying? No, I don't. Not fully, no. But was he living a life of holiness and purity? And was it about holiness and purity? Yes, it was. And so in that upheaval, now he says this girl's going to get healed, and she doesn't get healed. So now there's an uproar, because he's got another meeting right up here in L.A. Right up here in L.A. And his son's there on the phone, says, Dad, it's a mess up here with all the stuff that's going on that the preachers are saying. And all this. And then the girl didn't get healed the other night, or last night, I think it was. Yeah, last night. He says, where are you standing? And he told him an address over towards Southeast L.A. He said, before you die, the sharks will be swimming there. That, within several hours, the girl that he said was healed, she was completely healed. Okay, the reality of it is, people, there's a coming day of great disaster, and the prophets have prophesied about it, and people have declared it, and people sit around yawning like nothing's going to happen, like things are going to continue on as they were, and yet we're living in an urgent, needy time. People don't understand the urgency. You're actually like you're in a house, and it's burning down, and you're in one of the center rooms, and you're sitting there on the several floors up, and the thing is burning down. But you don't have a sense of where you're at, so the urgency isn't there. You think everything is safe and everything is okay. It's not. And then ultimately, if you've got compromises going on with the world, then all you are even in a deeper sleep, in a deeper place of deception, in a deeper place from being able to feel what God has to say. For me and for God's people that are going to walk with Him, the flame will not kindle upon me. And where we're at right now, the year 2016 is a crisis.
Yes.
The year 2016 is a crisis. And yeah, does the person that gets in the White House have some of an impact? Yeah, but it's far bigger than that. Right. And as far as I'm concerned, the choice is already made. Because the church of Jesus Christ chose the liberal progressive agenda,
right,
within the context of their own belief system. So it's already set. It's spiritually already set. Their only hope is the signs and wonders and miracles. I mean, you know, this weekend up in Burns, Oregon, the militia came out. The Oregon militia is pretty, they're not as big as the Montana and Idaho militia, but they're pretty hefty. They came out with their guns, and they came out with their stuff, and they took over a particular site and said, look, we're done with you. We're done with your overreach. And that's just one small example of the growing unrest in the United States of America. It's one small example. I'm telling you right now. The rural country boy militia is very frightening, and it's been being formed since the 60s, because I know preachers that started becoming leaders in it back in the 60s. Believe me, it's huge. And you know, the White House and everybody else knows about it. It's not a secret. They've not kept it a secret. And many of the generals that have fallen out, and majors and other high-ranking officers that have fallen out of the military are a part of them. And so they're not a bunch of, crazies. Listen to me. And I'm telling you this, in case you didn't know it, you're in the midst of great crisis. And I want you to wake up and recognize that your only hope, and our only hope for America, is for there's somebody to stand up and begin to move with God. If we move with God, He is a majority. He's going to plow the thing down. If He's got some people, some covenant people, to manifest His glory through. Amen. Somebody who's going to do what it is He's doing. Amen. Somebody who's going to agree with Him, because He's not going to be misrepresented. He's not going to show forth His glory and power in the midst of something that is going to profane the name of His Son. Amen. I don't want anybody to be overly, I don't want you to get frightened. I want you to get concerned. There should be no fear. You should find a place, they that dwell in the secret place of the Almighty. Hallelujah. Kata barosetiyara. There's nobody more organized in our cities than the gangs. They're highly organized. Everybody knows it. The FBI knows it. The local police know it. The structure that they can instantly put into place right here in San Diego, shock you. Just and all of a sudden now tyranny rules. The strong arm rules. It's just, you don't want that. I don't want that. God doesn't want that for this nation. But if there is no opposition to what we've invited into this nation, if there's nothing that's going to stand up with the authority of God, it's going to run roughshod over everything. You listen to me. It's going to run right over top of everything. When you invite demons into you and you become possessed by a devil, it works all kinds of destruction in your life. Are you listening to me? We as a nation invited the demons and devils to come and possess us. All in the name of liberalism and progressivism. All in the name of somehow having more freedoms for everyone. It's not freedom. Freedom, that is bondage. Freedom is only found in the liberties of walking with God and doing what's right and saying no to immorality. Because immorality ultimately works the worst kind of immorality, tyranny. And no one's had any of that for a while. But there's plenty of Hitlers to rise. Nobody's had that in for a while. You listen to me. But I guarantee you what Satan would do lurks in the shadows. It's lurking around right now. There's only one hope. I had a friend call me up on the phone just before I got in here. He said, I just don't even know what to do. I'm heartsick. I'm watching the news. They're burning the flag. I can't remember where it was here in the U.S. They're having these riots out on the street. He said, we've got to have a move of God. I said, would you be the move of God? True. Are you willing to be the move of God? Are you willing to forsake everything, to press in, to take a hold of God? Because he can be touched, and he can be reached, and he can be contacted. And he can. And when he is, and when he's touched, he'll release his power and his authority upon your life. And your generation and the world around you will be changed. I'm telling you right now, I'm not just talking to you about what I want to see you do. I'm talking to you about what I just said. Listen, I'm going to step it up another notch. I'm going to be consecrated just a whole nother level. I mean, God started doing something in my life. I was walking around the house the other day, and I'm telling you, our house is a sanctuary. Don't get me wrong. Our house is Bibles everywhere. I give myself continually to the Word. We give ourselves continually to the ministry of the Spirit. And I'm walking around the house going, honey, we got to get right. Christ Jesus is coming. Because there's a holy fear and indignation of God's wrath that's about to be poured out upon sin and iniquity. People think that they can shake their fist in the face of God and say, you can't tell us what to do. Oh, yeah, you can. Yeah. Watch. Watch. But before Father comes with his judgment, there's going to be plenty of demonic tyrants that is going to do it once again. And the subjugation is of men. Will be more than you can even imagine. And I can outline all this for you in the Word of God. I don't spend a lot of time there. Charisma is getting ready to publish a book that I just did. You can read it in the book. And you can look at all the scriptures and understand what's going down, what is happening. And the people, I'm desperate tonight to try to draw you into a place of living out a life where signs and wonders and miracles and the demonstration of the power of God can be revealed in your life. Where you said, look, I don't want to be a part of that iniquity. I'm not going to be a part of that place where the satanic actually dominates the minds of men. And they're saying that it's all good. No part of it's good. No part of it's good. Freedom and liberty is found in no more sin. Where sin is, just a little bit of it, it will result in wanting to kill God. Here's how it started. A demon spirit came and taught Adam how to disobey God. Came and taught Chava how to disobey God. Within 1665 years, the imaginations of men's heart, because of them listening to the demonic realm, was so wicked, God said, it repents me that I made man, and he destroyed the whole of humanity. Found one family, Noah, 8 people. That was it. And I say, righteous and just are your ways, O God. Yes. You can say whatever you want to say. You can say unjust. Fine, you have the right to do that. I'm saying righteous and just are your ways, O God. Amen. Your judgments are righteous and true altogether. I want to live in your world. I don't want to live in this world. I don't want to live in anybody else's world. I want to live in your world. I'm going with you, Father. I ask you, I want you to know, before all heaven and all the host of men in hell, I want you, God. I only want you. I only want your realm. I don't want nothing of this other stuff that's going down. Father, you have promised to give me those things which I have willed, and I will only you. And I will only you. I will only you. Hallelujah. I will only you, Lord. Stephen got a little touch from heaven. Hallelujah. In Acts chapter 6 and verse 8, and Stephen was full of faith and power. Listen, people, that's a meeting place. Let me tell you about Stephen, how he got full of faith and power. They were in the meeting every day, twice a day. I want to tell you about the meeting place. I'm telling you, they were living lives of just seeking God. They were living lives, community lives of the kingdom of God, just seeking God, just waiting on the Lord. It was just commonplace to have the gifts of healing. That's what the church looked like in his day. It was just commonplace to have the working of miracles. That's just what the church looked like in his day. It was just commonplace for the Holy Ghost to show up and Ananias and Sapphira fall down dead for lying. It just was the way it was in those days, because they were just set, their heart was set on God and not captivated by a sociology created by a demonic power to keep us from being those kinds of people. Oh, God, help us. God, help us. As we bow to the idols of work, as we bow to the idols of money, as we bow to the idols of debt, listen to me, and we serve them. Ruthless taskmasters, as we serve them. Oh, come on, you can break out of it. Come on now. You can break out of it. Halabaseki, you can break out of it. I'm telling you, it's a realm of faith. It's a realm of taking a hold of God. It's a realm of seeking the Lord. It's a realm of saying, you know what? It's better for me to spend my time seeking God than sitting here passively getting downloaded from hell. And doing all these other things and wasting my time. I'm just beginning to say, you know what? I'm going to seek God. I'm done with it. I'm done with all the plans and all the New Year's resolutions that fail by the time we get to February. I'm done with it. I'm done. I'm going to grab a hold of myself. If I got to grab myself by the back of my head, and I'm going to put myself over here in this corner, and I'm going to sit down and seek the Lord. I'm going to get to know God. I'm going to get quiet before His presence. I'm going to get still before His word. Come on, people. Come on. We got to have it. Stephen was full of faith and power, who went about doing what? Great wonders. Look at that. He went about doing great wonders. Great wonders. One man, great wonders. Bringing down the strongholds everywhere he went. God gave to us this divine power and authority to be the witnesses of heaven. He gave us this divine power and authority to break off the yoke. Because when you read Acts 26:18, it's the same as reading Luke 4:18. It's the same as Jesus saying, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because He's anointed me. It's the same as reading, He's given me the authority to open up the eyes of the blind, to turn them from darkness to light, from the power of Satan to the power of God, that they may receive forgiveness of sin and inheritance among all those who are the saints in light. We're going to have to be taught of God if we're going to go to this place that He's calling us to. Lehman, this day. If we could just keep turning the pages here, we'll find something on every page. Acts chapter 8. We can look at what happened with the preaching of Philip in Samaria, as he did mighty signs and wonders. Look at what happened to the people. They stood there marveling and wondering at all the things, that the miracles which he did. For unclean spirits came out, crying out with a loud voice. That's verse 7. Many that were possessed with the devil, and many taking in with the paralysis or palsies, and those that were lame, they were healed. And there was great joy in the city. They just stood beholding the miracles which Philip did. It broke off every yoke. It changed. Verse 13. Simon himself believed also when he and was baptized. He continued with Philip and wondered, beholding the miracles and signs which he did. That's what God has given to stop the forces of hell from advancing in the world that we live in. When Enoch and Elijah comes, they will do great signs and wonders, and through their great signs and wonders, they will stop the advancement of an invincible army led by Satan and the Antichrist. By themselves, two people. Two people with great signs and wonders. I'm telling you right now, we already know how Elijah is good at calling fire down out of heaven. Now it's going to come out of his mouth. People say they're going to go through the tribulation. Read my book. You're not going to go through the tribulation anymore. You won't want to go. You'll be horrified. All I do is itemize and lay out everything that the Bible says about it. That's all I do. It's just scripture. I hardly even use my own words. I just weave the scripture together. That's why it's so potent. Hallelujah. People, come on now. We're going to have some troops. One of the reasons I'm going to go tomorrow and raise this preacher from the dead is because we don't have enough resources as it is. He can't go die in an early death at 59 years of age. It's just to get the faith and authority received from heaven. That's all it is. Hallelujah. It's about time. It's about time for the greater works to begin. It's about time for that advancement of the things of the Spirit of the Lord to kick in, because there's been people that are standing around waiting on God who's not been willing to do it on their own or go it on their own. They've been faithfully waiting here, being fashioned and formed, having purified themselves from these things, being prepared unto every good work. There's a people of God right now waiting to be put into position by the Spirit of the Lord to start dealing with the opposition, the demonic forces that would try to take over the humanity before the time. In this nation, before the time, we can stand between the dead and the living.
Yes. Yeah, we can.
Hallelujah. And hold back the plague.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Mandos de vrisicasta la montipina. Beto da mosta. Hallelujah. It's about time people start standing around wondering, just hanging out, wondering at all the signs and the miracles which are going on. It's time. It's time, dear people. It's time. And it's not going to happen because you're going to sit around and continue to do the same things you're doing now. It's going to happen because you're willing to kick in a change. You're willing to begin to seek the Lord.
Yes.
When you look at Romans 15, 19, and you can turn there if you want. Paul said, I fully preached the gospel with signs and wonders and the demonstration of the power of the Holy Ghost. It's about time that there's be somebody who can rise up in the baptism of the Holy Ghost and the authority which God has given and begin going everywhere and doing those things which Christ Jesus has commissioned us to do. And of course, once again, if we're going to follow in Jesus' ministry, his ministry, Acts 10, 38, 48, how we understand how the God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power, who went about doing good, healing all that are oppressed of the devil. Listen, this is a place where you're trained and fashioned and matured and developed by the Holy Ghost, because you're there in a place where he can touch you, change you, fill you, show you these things that belong to heaven, where he can help you and strengthen you so that you won't be contaminated and held back by interference with respect to how you've been involved or integrated with the world system, with demonic powers and sin and iniquity. It's about time somebody gets some holy indignation in their life. Some fear of God on the level that you love righteousness and hate evil, and everywhere that you don't love righteousness and hate evil, you let God teach you how to do it, so you do it, you end up being just like he is in it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And you begin to have an authority to go forth with an ability by the Spirit of the Lord to stop every work of the demonic power and the satanic influence everywhere you encounter it, because it has nothing in you. It doesn't have any power in you or effect in you or influence in you. So long as it does, it's limited power. It's limited ability. It's about time Father has some witness of the resurrection around here.
Yes.
It's about time that a great moving of the Spirit break forth, instead of people just sitting around talking about how all, you know, the world's going to hell in a handbasket and the church is apostate and everybody's preaching all kinds of crazy doctrines. What are you doing? Until you start doing something, you don't even have a right to say anything, hardly. Get busy. Look at and go into the Word of God and then see what you would call the model of a person so full of the Holy Ghost and power, being everything that God has purposed man to be, and give yourself to be in that.
Amen.
Instead of sitting around talking about what, because you don't see nothing.
sitting around talking about, well, I don't see what the Bible's preaching, or teaching, or declaring we should be. Well, why don't you be it?
Amen.
You're listening to me. Yes. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. Hebrews 2:4, look at it. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It's time to seek the Lord. It's time to seek the Lord. It's time to separate yourself unto the Lord and go after Him.
Yes.
And let Him begin to search through every part of your life, and let the floodlight of heaven shine on every part of your life.
Amen.
And say, Father, I want to know that everything about my life is holy and acceptable unto You, and I want to keep it that way, and I know that You're going to give me all the power of heaven to be able to keep it that way. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You let the floodlight of heaven shine upon your life, and make sure that you're not allowing anything within your life that would keep Father from being able to say, well done, my good and faithful servant. I want to get a report every day. Father, how is it at the end of the day? Is it well done, my good and faithful servant? Because that's what I want to hear. I'm living in that realm. I'm not waiting. The more time you give yourself to supplication. Look, Daniel set his face to seek the Lord with prayer and supplication and with fastings and prayer and supplication in sackcloth and ashes. I mean, he got himself all the way down into a place of total brokenness and humility before the Lord, because he was earnest about the promises of God being fulfilled in his nation and being fulfilled among the people. He wasn't willing to be like all the rest and sing Kumbaya, or be like all the rest and sing Que Sera Sera as a second song, a hymn of choice. Whatever will be, will be. The future's not ours to see. Que sera, sera. It's just time that people get broken, that yoke is broken off.
Amen.
Of you, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And start recognizing the future is ours to see. And God has given us the authority, hallelujah, to prophesy.
Yes.
Amen.
I may just tell you something. I'm going to tell you one of my secrets. I open up the Bible and I start reading Isaiah chapter 55, and I cannot read Isaiah chapter 55. I cannot read it. I cannot see it. I can't read. And the word which proceeds out of my mouth shall not return unto me void. I can't see it. I'm telling you, I'm honest with you. All I can see is the word which goes forth out of your mouth shall not return unto me void. I'm not kidding you. I'll take a Bible, I'll open it up anywhere, and I'll start reading it. And though it says the word which goes out of my mouth should not return unto me void, I see it, I read it. The word which goes forth out of your mouth.
Amen.
There is a call that Father has for us. Just think about it. When we're speaking His word's going out of our mouth. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It's His word that's not returning void. But now He brings us into a relationship, into a partnership of divine authority if we're willing to respond. Look at the story. Father's saying to us, I've got a place, a fruit that I want to, a place I want to bring you to, a fruit I want to produce in you, that whatever you ask me, I'll do it. Whatever you ask the Father, whatever it is, whatever
Amen.
You ask the Father in my name, I'll do it. It's huge. It's needed. It's absolutely essential. It's not just needed. It's absolutely crucial. It's critical that somebody take a hold of God and know Father like this.
Amen.
We're too entertained with ourselves. We're too fascinated with ourselves. We've got to get over this.
Amen.
We've got to get over this.
Amen.
And we need to get captivated with the presence of the Lord. Because what Father did for the apostles and the disciples in the early church, He wants to do right now. He gave Himself a witness over and again that this is not just for a few, because He's poured out His Spirit upon all flesh. It's an opportunity that is given to all men. He cried out and said, anyone that believes, it doesn't matter who, anyone that believes, these works which I do, she do in greater works. He cried out on the Feast of Tabernacles, which was a gathering of great numbers of various people from all nations. He said, if anybody thirsts, come and drink, and out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. This spake he of the Holy Ghost, which was not yet given. And He was talking about receiving power and authority from on high. Power and authority from on high. Jesus said, all authority is given to me in heaven and earth.
Amen.
Right now, all authority is given to me in heaven and earth. God will not transgress the will of men. If the church is not going to stand up and be with them, if the church by idleness and by foolishness and by compromise is going to come under the power of Satan and be neutralized at best, it's the will of men. Father's not going to trespass it. He's going to let it go. He's going to let it run its ruin. He's a God of love and grace and mercy. And in his time that we fall in love with him enough to be willing to come under his sovereignty, his rulership. It's purely voluntary. Satan's going to force you. He's going to jerk you around whether you recognize it or not. He's going to make you do things that after you get finished doing them, you're going, how could have I ever done that? Because a taskmaster is ruling you. It's about time you break from his tyranny and get and take a hold of the blood that will erase his mark and his tattoo that's already on you. You listening to me? People are all concerned about 666. There's a marking going on right now. Satan marks people's souls. Tonight I pray that in Jesus' name that every person in this place, you will at least turn your heart over to the Lord to say, Father, I want to know you. I want to walk with you. And that you would just take another step. Some of you are ready to take another step and say, okay, Father, I'm ready to fully be used by you. I can't live without those things that you purpose for me to be. I can't live without this life and ministry of Jesus and being revealed through me. Watch what Father will do with you just with some simple request and then some follow through, some obedience that follows through. Commitment. He sees. He hears every prayer. He knows how earnest the prayer is. He's not in a hurry. He's looking. What he's got to give is sacred. Huh? What he's got to give goes beyond anything that can be valued with money. He's looking. Are you sure you really want this? No, this is what this is how he talks. I'm glad to hear you say yes. And his father's saying, are you sure you really want this? Are you really willing to deny yourself, take up your cross and follow me? Are you really, really willing to live to do my will and not your own? He sees the compromise that it goes on in life where we're living at right now and realizes how intense it's going to be once we begin to move in that kind of authority, because then suddenly we become that much more of a target for every demon power. And Tim Hall, Evangelist Tim Hall, was sharing with me today. He said, when you start going into these big nations, because he just was in Venezuela, and he said, the Colombians told me they don't even go into Venezuela. And he just had great meetings in Venezuela. And he'd just been into Burma. He said, you go in these countries, he said, the backlash of hell is intense. And it's true. It is so intense. You become the primary target because you're walking with an authority to open up the blind eyes. Satan wants to take you out. And see, he's got all kinds of little tricks. And what can he get you with? Where are you vulnerable? Where's your vulnerability? Where are you going to capitulate, cave in? Huh? And now, Father wants to do a perfecting work in our life. Hallelujah. He wants to bring us into the fullness of the measure, the maturity, the ministry of Jesus, even unto a fully matured man. But we've got to cooperate with him. He wants us to be vessels prepared unto every good work. But we've got to be willing to be purified of these things. We've got to be willing to come out from among them. We're going to have to be willing to perfect holiness in the fear of God and abstain from every appearance and everything that looks like an evil, and cleanse ourselves from the filthiness of the flesh and make everything that belongs to sin so filthy it's like what you flush down the toilet. Because that's what it's worse than that to God. Praise God for toilets. Hallelujah. I'm one thankful person for over toilets. Hallelujah. I praise God every time. I'm like, thank you, Father, for toilets. Hallelujah. To remove this foul stuff from out of our midst. Not to trip over it. There's a lot of countries you go to. It's just right down. You're constantly walking over it. It's just a stream right down the middle of the back alley. They don't know Jesus. It's under the power of Hinduism or under the power of Buddhism. It's just filthy. Or under the power of the reign of a demon spirit. I can take you to some jungle places in Indonesia, in Irian Jaya. Papua New Guinea. It's so foul. They're under the grip of a demon power. And the anthropologist says, leave them alone. I don't want to leave them alone. You know what kind of sacrifices they do to devils so that the devil doesn't come and kill their baby? You know what kind of legend and myth and demon worship they live in? I'm going to set them free from that mess.
Amen.
Hallelujah. It's. I'm telling you, God's given us a mission vision for the United States of America as well as the rest of the world. We want you to get engaged in it. We want you to get engaged in it. Because I'm going to tell you right now, you'll be able to see very clearly what we're doing when all this stuff starts coming down. But if you had to wait till then, you'll get nothing. Nothing happened. You'll get to put nothing together. You got to be able to see out into the future. Praise God. The Holy Ghost allows us to see out into the future. He shows us things that are to come. He gets us ready. He puts it strong in our heart and a passion and then empowers us to do it. And we're always, anytime we're doing anything in the kingdom of God, there's battles to fight. There's a good fight, a faith to fight. It is not something that just, you know, coasting down the stream on the little floaty. It's an uphill battle. It's an uphill battle. The Lord strengthens us and gives us the grace to do it. Praise the name of Jesus. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 4. We just need this. We've got to have it now. We've got to have it now. Don't delay. You know, I was telling the Lord, don't delay. And, you know, and you could just hear Father laughing. You're the one delaying, man. You guys are delayers. I'm not delaying at all. I'm like ready. I'm ready for the program to begin. I've been standing here with everything. Like I'm just standing here with my hands holding it out. Can you listen to me?
Yes.
But it's much easier to sing to the Lord, Lord, don't delay, than to sing to you, don't delay. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
Because He graciously receives it. If I say it to you, you get all upset. I'm saying, don't delay, Lord. Do something sovereign now. Do something that captivates your people's lives. That they just can't resist you anymore. They can't turn a blind eye towards you anymore. They've got to follow you and go all the way with you. I'm going to do that. I'm going to do that right now. Hallelujah. If it was a dry season, you know what? If there was no evidence of anything of God, still I'd be seeking Him, laying hold on Him. I'd be like Habakkuk. Hallelujah. Sorry, I've been proven in my life. I would be like Habakkuk. Though there be no calf in the stall, no fruit on the vine, no laughter, no making merry, yet I go and seek the Lord. I go upon my high place and see what the Lord has to say. I will rejoice and delight in my God, and I go upon my high place and see what the Lord has to say when He corrects me. Hallelujah. 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 We're on it, dear people. We're on it. We're on the verge. We are on the verge of a great outpouring of the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
It looked 2016 looks very bleak for the world, but very beautiful for the kingdom of God. It looks very bleak in terms of the things people trusting in government. My goodness gracious, you got what do you got? Trump or Hillary? Goodness, if that's all you got for hope, you in sad situation. You in a sad circumstance, man. I mean, goodness gracious. I don't know. I'm still not certain which one's worse. I'm still like, I'm asking God for insight on which one's worse, the worst of two evils. You're listening to me. God, help us. Huh? Either one of them make the days of Obama look like heaven. It just appears that way to me. It just appears that way to me. I have a sense inside about it. I don't care anything about it, really, to tell you the truth. America wasn't discovered and found on the basis of a president in the White House. No, my ancestors came here with the Bible in their hand. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise God. They set their foot on the soil of this nation in the early 1600s. Praise the name of Jesus in 1610 and said, this is for the name of Jesus Christ. For we take this land for the kingdom of our God and of His Christ.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And his ancestors persecuted my ancestors because his ancestors were Puritans and my ancestors were Quakers. We shook, they didn't, so they got upset. We believed in miracles, they didn't, so they can, you know, come on. I don't need nobody to tell me what my history is. I don't need nobody to tell me what my family history is. I don't need some textbook from somebody who came here, you know, 60 years ago to tell me what my family history is. It's absolutely insanity. There's too many witnesses. There's too many people. Too many families been here for a very, very long time. Hallelujah. Some of my family was on the boat, and some of them were standing on Plymouth Rock. Hallelujah. And this is the way it is. For many people been here, family's been here for a long time. Listen, our blood is in this ground for the gospel. Not our blood is in this ground for fighting, taking it by violence. Our blood is in this ground for the gospel. Hallelujah. I'm not letting it go to hell. I ain't going to go to hell. And it isn't going to be by legislation. And it isn't going to be by some judicial means and some banner and some placard and whatever. It's going to be by the power of God. Watch what happens when some people stand up in the authority of God. That's how the Constitution was formed in the first place. Because people stood up like George Whitefield in the power of God in the 1700s. And you've got Thomas Jefferson and you've got Benjamin Franklin, and you've got other people being touched by those meetings, the power of God going forth, and it's called the First Great Awakening in the United States of America. It shook this nation out of it, came the Constitution of the United States, something that would protect us in our liberty to pursue the things that Father has purposed us to do, a shield against infringements upon the gospel. Praise God for the shield. It still exists. They cannot stop me.
Amen.
They cannot tell me what I cannot say. I will preach the gospel, regardless, anyway. I will tell men when they're sinning and when they're bringing destruction in. Praise God for it, too. Praise God, our passport still works anywhere. You know, I just got a burden for Southern Jordan. I just got a great burden for Southern Jordan. I want to go to Southern Jordan. Hallelujah. Got a great burden for the Sacros Mountains. I got to get over in the Sacros Mountains. Amen. He said, you can't go to Jordan. They'll kill you. No, I can go there and not get killed. You can't. Oh, we're getting ready to go to the Kashmir Valley. You can't go to the Kashmir Valley. They're going to kill you there. That's where all the Pashtuns are, the Al-Qaeda fighters. No, I'll be fine.
Amen.
I'll be fine. Hallelujah. I'll be fine. Hallelujah. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. He's given me authority to go, and wherever the soles of my feet step, the power of God then begins to shake the land. Yeah. Come on, people. Let's get in it. Let's get in it. You know, go big or go home. Home's heaven, hopefully. Amen. Hallelujah. It's time to just say, God, I tell you, it's just time to go big. Hallelujah. Have you ever been in the Kashmir Valley? You've been in the Kashmir Valley? Well, we're headed there. You weren't a Christian there. You were just some stupid American doing the Hindu thing. Thank you, Father, for deliverance. You need to go back there. You need to go back there full of the Holy Ghost. You're having all kinds of troubles there. I have the answer. His name is Jesus. There's 40 million Pashtuns in those mountains right in that area, and that just above the Kashmir Valley, there in the Afghan mountains, Pakistan mountains, Afghan mountains, Tajikistan. It's one huge mountain ridge. 40 million. They believe that they're the tribe of Ephraim. It was deported back in 700 BC by Sargon II, Sennacherib's dad. An Assyrian tyrant who God allowed them to overthrow Israel because Israel had given themselves over to their gods. So because Israel had given themselves over to worship the gods of the Assyrians and all kinds of terrible blasphemy, said, oh, you want those gods? Okay, then I'm going to let them come and rule you. I'm going to let them come take over you. You get to see what they're... I'm not going to hold those gods back anymore. I'll let you see what you're really worshiping. And it's pretty intense because they've been scattered in diaspora and deported for 2,700 years now. Basically, the southern kingdom was only deported for about 70 years. And you can see the difference, the spiritual nature and climate of the two. Even though both of them did wickedly. There, at least there was some moves of revival. There was some moves of seeking God. There was still some kind of a remnant of people that still wanted to lay hold on God. There was still a Daniel in the midst. There was still an Ezra in the midst. Huh? There was still a Mordecai in the midst. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Praise God for His mercy. When people like you and I gather around His word as we are tonight and begin to contemplate the things that need to be adjusted in our life so that we can move on into what He's called us to do and to be, so that we can lay hold, so that we can, with just a responsive heart, because it's big to Father, responsive heart to simply say, Father, I want that in my life. I want what You sent the Holy Ghost for. I want that authority in my life. I want that power and that demonstration. I want to be a part of seeing the yoke broken off of people's lives. I want to be a part of seeing everywhere Satan exists, him destroyed by Your anointing. When that's what you want, sin isn't going to become much of an entertainment anymore. Huh? Sin is going to be something that's sitting over there that you're thinking about maybe doing. It's something you kill. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's something you destroy. Praise God. You take the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, and amen. Hallelujah. It's not for buttering bread. It's for cutting heads. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Preshakataya la mostis. For killing things. And we're not talking about earthly things. We're talking about spiritual things. Yeah. Weapons of our warfare, they're not carnal, but mighty through God. It's about time we learn how to use them.
Yeah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. It's about time we learn how to use them. It's about time we understand what they are. Maybe people don't even know what they are. How can you use? I mean, you know what I'm saying. And put some of you, there's a couple of types of weapons I could put in your hand, and you wouldn't even know how to pull the trigger on it. You don't even know how this thing works. You put one of those big 50 caliber sniper rifles in your hand, and you're like, what on earth? The thing's like 15 foot long. It's not quite that long, but with a couple of safeties on it, you've got all kinds of gizmos that you've got to get right, and then the kick is going to scare you to death. No, and we're saying for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty. Through God, well, what are the weapons? How do we even understand what the weapons are? How do we begin to effectively use them? I pray in Jesus' name that you begin to move in and make the things that Father has available for you more important than anything else, that you give more time to it than you would give to the other things that you've been captivated by, the other things that you pursued in your life. Just start giving time to the Word like you did to your education. Come on, new people. Listen to me. I said this morning, I don't know about you, no one just came up and pinned it on my lapel and said, here you go, here's your degree. Mine took a lot of work. My degrees took quite a bit of work. They didn't come by. Joshua, how long have you been down here? They've had you basically on the doctorate program now, including the master's run. What has it been, like 8 years?
Six years.
Seems like eight. And I'm telling you right now, it's brutal. It's brutal. Joshua said one day, he said, Dad, I guess if you can just handle never being good enough and never doing it well enough, then in the end you're going to get the degree. It was something like that, right?
Yeah. Critique.
Just constantly being critiqued. Are you willing to do that with the Holy Ghost?
Yes.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, really? Because, you know, everybody knows that he chastens every son that he receives, but then when the chastening starts going down, people start scattering, you know, like a bomb's going off. It's like, what's going on now? I'm getting chastened. Hello?
Yeah.
I'm getting corrected, instructed. Yeah, you are. That's what God put in the church. Because you weren't trained right by your parents. I'm sorry. I'm sure your parents were just wonderful people. They didn't train you right.
No.
And then I'm going to go ahead and add to that. Your teachers just messed it up even worse.
Amen.
And now you're sitting here and you got a job of work to do. Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
It is a job of work to do. And so it's going to be coming at you right, left, and center. So don't be surprised it's coming at you right, left, and center, seeing as you so desperate about laying a hold of the things of God and moving on with his program, being fashioned after what he demands of our lives.
Amen.
I'm sorry, I wish that it were better with your parents. I wish your parents would have modeled for you the outpouring of the Holy Ghost on a daily basis. Maybe some of you that are raised in this church, maybe that is so. But then if they shift you off to the satanic school, I mean to the school system, the school of Satan and demonic indoctrination, strip you of all ego and reshape you in our own image and tell you exactly what you're supposed to believe, and it's all lies. The math isn't lies, but the rest of it is. The math is provable. Chemistry's are pretty provable too. Can you hear me?
Yes.
I'm talking about you right now, and you up against the Lord. And it's about time we just let Father's word rule us. Come rule me. The Lord Jesus is going to rule the earth with a rod of iron. Will you let him rule you now with a rod?
Yes.
Hallelujah. He's going to smash everything.
Amen.
He's going to smash everything. He is like a potter smashes the clay vessels. Beautiful. And every smash is going to be most excellent smash. He's going to smash sin and smash rebellion and smash iniquity and smash everything that produces death and destruction. Hallelujah. Good news, eh? Bad news for everybody else that loves sin. Good news for everybody who doesn't, who loves God. Amen. Let me read this verse of Scripture to you. I don't want to stop. I want to break through into the realms of your life to where that everything about you is so wide open to receive what Father has to give you right now, that this place explodes with the divine power of God, with the gushings of deep emotions, the gushings of deep emotions of crying out to the Father, the gushings of deep praise issuing out of your life. Yes, Lord Jesus. Yes, Lord Jesus. Hebrews 2:4. God also bearing them witness, both with signs and wonders, and with many different kinds of miracles, and the gifts of the Holy Ghost according to his will. This is the only way that the gospel becomes effective in our lives and in our midst. And there's a price to pay. And you can be lazy about it and leave the work for somebody else to do. You're going to miss out on the glorious fellowship, though. You're going to miss out on the opportunity to live big forever in God. It doesn't matter how old you are. It doesn't matter how much you've delayed. It doesn't matter how much wrong choices you made. Today, Father makes everything new. Today is a new beginning. Today, you get to start completely over. Today, it's all everything starts fresh. It's just God's mercy. There's no one so merciful as he is. There's no one so long-suffering as he is. He doesn't let up and doesn't give up on anybody who's willing. Anybody who's willing to be something different than the devil. But he's never going to agree with the devil. He's never going to agree with sin and iniquity. He's never going to agree with death and destruction. He's going to destroy it. Praise God. He's going to annihilate it. People say, why does hell have to be fire? Because it's got to be pain. Because as long as people are in torment and pain, they're not going to be doing any evil things. They're going to be in pain forever. Hell is an eternal torture chamber. And it's a display of God's hatred and anger against every form of sin. And people need to get it. They want to hear about it. Oh, don't tell me about hell. Don't tell the kids about hell. They're going to have bad dreams. I'll tell them early. You listening to me?
Yeah.
Don't tell them about hell. Tell them about Santa Claus. Don't tell them about hell. Tell them about the Easter Bunny. Don't tell them about flames and fire and punishment and wrath. Tell them about the Tooth Fairy. Real sensible. Real sensible. Wonder who you got taught by. Wonder who your mentor was. Made you think like that. And you listening to me. Jesus. The Word of God, just giving you the Word of God, teach you how to think different. Laying a hold on His righteous judgments. Hallelujah. If there's anything children need to learn about, they've got to learn. They've got to come to an understanding. And the earlier, the better. The things that you need to learn about is this. You need to hate all evil. God hates it.
Yes.
And you need to love righteousness.
Amen.
You need to choose that which is good and refuse that which is evil. And it starts really early. And there's a lot of challenges in it. There's a whole lot of challenges in it. Because they're so cute and so adorable and we love them so much. And now they need to be spanked. Jesus. Father, I thank You for the working of Your mighty power in our midst. We thank You for Your love. We thank You for the fire of the Holy Ghost. We thank You, Father, for the willingness of every person in this place to change, to let their lives be completely reorganized by You, Holy Spirit, to give themselves thoughtfully, to give themselves with great dedication to walking with You, Holy Spirit, every second of the day. Father, thank You for the change. Father, I thank You for the prayer and the supplication, the petitioning prayer that's going to be going up from this place. A petitioning prayer that continually gives You no rest day or night. That is like taking up the themes that Geneva mentioned to me earlier today in Acts chapter 12 and verse 5. Where when Peter was put in prison, they prayed without ceasing. They prayed continually for his release. That's that supplication prayer where people get focused on the things that they're asking Father to do and they don't let up. And there's no power of darkness that can hinder that. There's nothing that can hold it back. I'm going to tell you right now, it's about time we start moving in the same directions, because when we do, we're going to find about the effectiveness of prayer, the power of prayer, the authority of it. We're going to find the effectiveness of sitting in the presence of God and waiting on Him, and how that we rise up from that place with great authority and with great faith and with great boldness in the faith. Complete restructuring of our lives. I want you to stand with me. Complete restructuring of your life. Bando de Sitaya. Complete restructuring of your life. Hallelujah. Resend in a kashitolo mosataya. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We want all of you to agree with us in prayer as we go to Mississippi. We just covet you praying, just petitioning the Lord that we would be able to move into a realm of authority and the gift of faith to see John raised from the dead.
Amen.
You know, you look at a life of that life cut short, 59 years old, massive heart attack, on a second day of fasting. You always fast 21 days, first 21 days of every year. Stepping into his giftings, just stepping into his calling, many doors opened. A person that never held back, bringing everyone, no matter what it was, business deal, didn't matter what it was, bringing them to a decision for Jesus Christ. We can't do without that. There's no one to take his place. I don't know anyone in the whole region that stood for the gospel. People call them from all over to come and pray. The prayer of faith over their sick family members. And the great signs and wonders and healing power. And then just all of a sudden have a massive heart attack. I just say it's demonic. Just have a massive heart attack and he's dead before you get to the hospital. It's done. It's over. He was just on the phone with Geneva the other night, and on New Year's Eve night, laying out the huge plan, the great plan that for 2016. All the things, all the doors that are open, all the things they're going to do. Just recently had a guy come, and a very wealthy person, say, going to finance all the crusades. And I mean, I already had 6 crusades lined up, but it was over $100,000 anyway, so. And if you just keep lifting up your voice in prayer, just continue supplication prayer. Yeah. Supplication prayer is a prayer of petition, a petition that keeps asking. It's a petition prayer. It's a continual request. It's the prayer of the widow who comes and continually wearies the judge by her much coming to petition.
Yes.
That's what we're doing. We're just hallelujah. Sudeep, I think Sudeep's watching right now. He says he's going to fly in from Nepal to come pray. He doesn't really need to. He can come if he wants. Just getting that many more people to pray. Hallelujah. We have to press into these kinds of events. Because I've been seeing him all day. I've been seeing myself all day walking there, and as soon as I touch him, his eyes open up. And I say, I say to him, "How you doing, John?" And he's gonna go, "Hey, man." That's what he always says. "Hey, man. Hey, man." Sounds like "Amen," but it's "Hey, man." "Hey, man."
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Purashandekinamala. I was having a little imagination today that. Just get there tomorrow night, raise him up, and then say, let's just go with the funeral service. Just crawl back in the casket. Because I think it'd be more dramatic, you know. Because, see, you just spend time with the Lord, and you can imagine. Otherwise, if you don't spend time with the Lord, you're going to imagine the bad thing, the negative thing. It ain't going to work. Everybody's going to be crying. You're going to be a pallbearer. Or whatever, you always imagine the wrong thing when you don't spend time in the presence of the Lord. You spend time in the presence of the Lord, you always imagine the right thing.
Yes.
You get holy imagination.
Yes.
You get faith imagination.
Yes.
Huh? You get signs and wonders and miracles imagination.
Yes.
Get imaginations about like 40 million Pashtuns giving their life to Jesus.
Yes.
You know, it's crazy imagination. Holy Ghost crazy imagination.
Yeah. Like, amen.
Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Hande bonasada dea. Si boranan jesekito romoshikaya. Irido romoshikarama. Events like this change everything. John has had his little tent up out there on the property, and nobody's been coming. Just very few people come. Even though anybody comes, pretty much signs and wonders, miracles are happening still, just because, you know, it's just the people under the grip of religion and the power of sin. I guarantee you, after tomorrow night, this place will be filled.
Yeah.
I mean, we have to have events like this. We have to have events. And they have to become of such magnitude that it can't be marginalized and hidden under a bush, hidden under the bed.
Amen.
It's got to be such events, such reproducible events, that it doesn't matter who comes and investigates. Say, yeah, you know what? I don't know if we want to report on this. Of course, CNN's only going to report on stuff that they found wasn't true. They're probably not going to report on something they found was true.
Yeah. That's true.
And I think I'm picking on CNN because Fox is their sister and owned by the same people. And so they just, same writers, just they write in a few buzzwords for the progressives and liberals over here and said same wording. Now they just put in a couple of conservative words to throw a bone to the whatever. You with me? Don't listen to that stuff. It's nonsense anyways. You live just fine without listening to all that.
True.
Are you listening to me?
Yes.
My wife never watched the news, and she's just fine.
Yes.
Amen.
A great piece of they which don't watch the news.
Amen. This is true. It's all doubt, unbelief, and misery. Turn it off.
Yeah.
Nothing to do with God. Nothing to do with the truth. If you believe it, you're going to be ensnared. So we just give ourselves. We give ourselves to the great events. We're going to give ourselves to the outpourings of the Holy Ghost. We're going to give ourselves to revival fire. And in so doing, Father is going to begin to do a work in us. And he's going to say, I want this changed. I want that changed. Look, I love you, but I don't want you doing this. And you're going to have to be willing to cooperate with him. Say, yes, sir. Okay, Father. Yes, I'll do that. Yes, I'll make those adjustments. And he's so long-suffering and patient with us. Hallelujah. 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 You don't have to guess either. I guarantee you don't have to guess. You don't have to make things up in your mind. When Father talks, it's beautiful. He speaks very, very loud. He says, this is what you need to do. He usually points it out when we're ready to change. If we're not ready to change, we can't. He doesn't usually point it out. You got to hear that. You got to be ready to change. You got to be serious. You got to be real with God on that. Father, we just want you to come move in our midst. Lord, we're just so desperate for you to come and move in our lives. Lord, we're just so desperate to be those people that you describe in your word, those people that you redeemed us to be. We're just so desperate to be that. Lord, we'll do anything that you ask. We'll go anywhere you want us to go. We'll do anything that you want us to do. Healed right now in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Anybody have any sickness in their body? Anybody in sickness in their body? Disease in their body? The Lord Jesus wants to heal you right now. Anyone? Anyone? The power of God is present to heal.
Yes.
The power of God is present to heal. Anyone else just come? Let me say this to you guys. You know, I know some people, they've actually kind of got a formula. If someone dies, everybody goes to fasting and pray for 3 days. I mean, think about if you lived in a community that if someone dies, everybody goes fasting and praying for 3 days to raise them up. If somebody's sick and diseased, everybody goes to intercessory prayer over it as though it's their own self or their own loved one. I'm going to tell you right now, that begins to bring a change within any community, within any church. I pray that you're going to be a part of that and just don't leave the work for somebody else to do.
Amen.
Say, well, we prayed. How long did you pray? About 25 seconds. Really? Was it worth 25-second prayer? Well, I know so-and-so. He just laid hands on somebody and they got healed. Well, that ain't what we're doing right now.
Right.
This is something that takes a little bit more than just somebody just laying their hands on them. It takes some intercessory prayer. It takes some people being committed to seeing it through. What's wrong? In the name of Jesus. That is hectic. You need to be having more protection. You do stuff like that. Well, just be healed right now in Jesus' name. The violent effect of this toxic thing against your body, I command it now in Jesus' name to be undone. Be healed. Be healed in Jesus' name. Pain goes from your body. Jesus' name. You touch any deadly thing, it should not affect you. Jesus. 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 Well, the pain goes from your body. All the impact of this thing goes from your body. Jesus. What's wrong with you?
What's wrong with me? First of all, I have a cold, and it's also from my mental illness.
Okay. What kind of mental illness do people say that you have, or does the doc say?
I actually don't know what it is.
What's wrong? What happens to you?
What happens to me, usually I start shaking, I get really violent.
Get really angry?
Yeah, really violent.
Okay. Two things we're going to do. We're going to pray for you that this virus will leave your body, and we pray that this demon power, it tries to work in your life. It's worked in your life. Leaves and can come and influence you no more. In Jesus' name. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Both of them. Now in Jesus' name. Your infection and flu, get off this body now in Jesus' name. Now! In Jesus' name. Satan, you take your hands off this bro. In the name of Jesus. You foul spirit of violence and anger. You foul demon of hell that would harass this life. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I command you to leave him alone. In Jesus' name. In the name of the Most High God. From this day forward, I paint you with the blood of Jesus Christ, the protection of the power of God and the Holy Ghost. Satan cannot touch you. In Jesus' name, everything about your life changes. Hallelujah. Jesus. Father, I pray in Jesus' name that every person in this place takes a hold of the authority that you've given to us. The authority to cast out devils. The authority to tread upon scorpions and serpents and all the power of the enemy. The authority to lay hands on the sick and they recover. The authority to move in the commission that you've given and the words that you've spoken, because you have all authority in heaven and earth, and you're just looking for somebody to agree with you. For someone to come into agreement. Hallelujah. Manny, how are you doing? What's up?
Just I want prayer for more desire.
Okay.
And then, cancer and also just my head.
Is there any cancer still on you? Where is the cancer? Huh? It is?
Yeah.
In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, look at me. I burn out the cancer. The foul spirit of affliction and torment cannot reoccur, cannot come back. It has to dissolve. Is there any growth on it right now on you? Good. It cannot come back. Your body, in the name of Jesus Christ, will be healthy in Jesus' name. And Father, I thank you right now for strengthening Manny in his inner being. Lord, that he stand against the fiery darts of the wicked one, that he be able to submit himself in every way, oh God, to those things that you've spoken in your word, that you've declared in your word, that the hunger and the thirsting would arise in his heart, that his whole life would be turned over to you, Father. Be nothing held back. In the name of Jesus. Every stronghold of the mind, every lying power of darkness that would try to torment your mind and your thinking, I silence it right now in Jesus' name. I silence it right now in the name of Jesus. Jiristakarama musateya. Ribastakaraneya. Take hold of peace. Just take hold of the peace. Ha. Ha. Just take hold of the peace. Just take hold of the peace, Manny. Just take hold of the peace. There's the power of the living God right here. Hallelujah. A change in Jesus' name. Change in Jesus' name. Thank you, mighty God. Thank you, mighty God. Thank you, mighty God. Thank you, mighty God. Mora mamanda de sekiri danda, Lord. Just stay right there, just seeking the Lord. What's up? How are you doing? How's your body? Huh? Has anything changed in your body? Okay. But as far as anything else, you don't know whether anything's changed? You haven't been checked? Your heart's still beating fast? Just look at me. In the name of Jesus. Jesus. Healed right now in Jesus' name. Put your hand on your chest. Healed right now in Jesus' name. Healed right now in Jesus' name. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. 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 Ipramo Sunday Ishte. Ipramo in the sheep on the day. Fire of the Holy Ghost. Fire of the Holy Ghost. Fire of the Holy Ghost. Mandanda se rikaya. The great outpouring, the floods of heaven to your life. The great outpouring, the flood of heaven to your life.
Yes, Lord.
What's up? What's up? In Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Speak healing right now. Infection go out in the body. Healed. Healed in Jesus' name. What's going on with you? What's up, Jacob? Father, in the name of Jesus, I ask you to grant this request of Jacob, that you raise him a mighty warrior. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, by the power of the living God. Father, I thank you for the anointing of the Holy Ghost that trains him from a child. Lord, that mentors him and works within the midst of his life to bring him to a place of great faith and authority. Zezuzai, Zezuzai, you be healed. I command it now and you obey me. Hallelujah. What's up? Okay.
It hurts and it transfers the lower back.
Well then let's just get it healed. Let's just let it be healed right now. Father, we thank you for the anointing of the Holy Ghost that heals. Jesus heals. The power and the authority that is in his name heals just the same way the power and the authority that is in his name saves. I command you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth to be healed. Now, right there in your back, that the pain goes out, that the physiological restrictions are no more. Now, in Jesus' name. Healed. Father, heal Ethiopia. I love Ethiopia. I love all the people from Ethiopia. I know her name. I just pray over Ethiopia every time I pray over. Sutaras te kia di vishaya. Ibrar te di alam musapratari. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for the miracle. Zoe, what's up? You just got pain? Jesus. Just let your hands towards heaven. Jesus. Touch Zoe now. Now in Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Pain goes from out of your body in Jesus' name. Pain leaves in Jesus' name. The glory of heaven comes, fills you. Feels. Mandam redestiki. Jesus. Now in Jesus' name I command you to be healed. What's up? In Jesus' name, congestion leave the baby. In Jesus' name. Go.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Little brother, what do you need?
I want to be able to tap into boldness and authority towards the loss, especially my my classmates at school that that I'm away from for these next few months, and for my relatives too, because before coming in, I was frightened by my dad when he says, like, you and your sister are becoming radical Christians, or too radical, something like that. And then I was afraid to say something until, like, later on in the service.
Okay, so you want to tap into boldness.
Yes.
Okay. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. You got to tap, I tell you right now. And all you have to do is say, Holy Spirit, fill me with your boldness. It's just a responsive. It's a relationship. Just a responsiveness to him, you ask and he feels. It really becomes that. And the more you do that, the more you have that relationship where you ask, Father responds, the stronger it gets. So the more powerful, the more effective the asking becomes. Hallelujah. And you just tell your dad, say, it ain't going to be long, you won't be just like me. Amen.
Amen.
Ain't that right?
Yeah.
Amen. Ain't going to be long. You're going to be right there at church with us being radical too. Hallelujah. That's right. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Fire of the Holy Ghost. In the fistarum. Fire of the Holy Ghost. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Every yoke broken. Every hindrance removed. Right now in the name of Jesus. In dandulo sikeris to pay ni. In the mighty name of Jesus. Zizaraba sataramandete. From the crown of your head to the soles of your feet, burning with the presence and the glory of heaven. In the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. What's up? What's up? Bless your heart. Touch Jenny now. Touch Jenny now. Touch her now. Touch her now, Lord. Touch her now. Touch her now, Lord Jesus. Every pain goes out of her body. Fill her up, oh God. Strengthen her by your spirit inside. Inside and outside, in Jesus' name. Jesus. Anybody dealing with any harassing, tormenting things in your mind, just internally, I want you to come and just give you my peace. The Lord said I'd give my peace to anybody that asks. Now, Jonathan's getting ready to go to Shreveport. And we've got to find a church for him. He can go help his mom. Right?
Yes.
And I'm giving you my peace right now. Look over here. Jonathan, I love you very much. I gave you my peace, man. The torment has to shut down. Any tormenting, harassing thing is leaving you alone.
Amen.
So you just lift your hands towards heaven. Get happy.
Yes, sir.
Hallelujah. Jesus. Touch my dear brother, Brad. Touch him, Father. Overwhelm him with your peace, oh God. Overwhelm him with your peace, oh God. I pray right now in Jesus' name. My peace I give to you. La ramos de derikis de redata de ditata la mosse preti. In a master to remain, she call almost to take. Thank you, Jesus, for the anointing. Thank you, Lord, for your miracle. Thank you, Lord, for the working of your mighty power right now. Jesus. Jesus, thank you for the outpouring of the Holy Ghost through this life. Thank you, Father, for your signs and wonders now. Irimasta orinaya. Jesus. Mambrate. Mandos, what do you want? What do you want to say? Just receive right now. Faith. Faith. How are you doing, sweetie? What do you want the Lord Jesus to do for you? You've been having bad dreams. Well, you look at me right now. You're not going to have bad dreams no more. Pastor says, no way. Can't do that.
Amen.
Pastor says, no bad dreams allowed. Okay? We must obey the pastor. The Lord says so. And in Jesus' name, a tormenting, harassing thing, you give off, get off the daughter of the Lord, the property of the Most High. In Jesus' name. Right now, Father, I thank you for your goodness and your grace and your mercy and your protection. There'll be no more bad dreams. There'll be no more effects of fear in your life. In Jesus' name. Now,
stand up to Vaughn and just a lot of mental games and just, you know, just so much that, you know, things he says and trying to pull me away from church and I just need to be bolder.
Father, we thank you for boldness and for wisdom.
Yes,
Lord. And in the name of Jesus. Yes. Learning how to flow in the Holy Ghost and respond out of the Spirit of the Lord is the way to live. Now, you know how to touch that realm, at least when you're in church. Now, you're going to just have to step up a little bit and understand how to touch that realm elsewhere.
Amen.
This realm. Bokanda de Shtepitalon. So you just become overwhelmed by the goodness of God and the presence of God. Then you speak out of that. You function and operate out of that. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's right. Somebody starts harassing you, start flowing in the Holy Ghost, start having joy while they're harassing you. Get overwhelmed with joy. It'll really throw them off balance. What's up? What's up, man? Hands towards heaven. Just enjoy the presence of the Lord. Now, in Jesus' name, give me my peace. I gave you my peace. Take hold of it. I give it to you. I give you my peace. Peace I give to you. I prosso taranishi mananamakotia. Jess, how are you doing?
Just want to increase my hunger.
Okay.
Go deeper in prayer.
Okay. Let not your heart be troubled. Jesus said, you believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house is many dwellings. If it were not so, I wouldn't have said it. I go to prepare a place for you, that where I am, you may be with me. And I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, you may be with me. Jesus. Lord Jesus. Be apprezzast. Pinto tante. Pinto tante de tantost. Pinto panteste. Meveritist. Right out of your belly flows the gushing force of the Holy Ghost, yes. Right out of your belly flows the gushing force of the Spirit of the Lord. The great outpourings. Mandakeste prete. Mandakeste. Yeah, you just keep doing that. You just keep doing that, and it'll get stronger. You just keep doing that. Sikanda la bondade. Just keep doing that, and it gets stronger and stronger. And then it turn into a diversity of language. And then it turn into prophecy and all kinds of utterance in the Holy Ghost. Yeah. Father, we ask you to do in Jess's life that which only you could do. Father, we thank you for a great peace, great healing within her heart, within her life. Now in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Father, I thank you that you take a hold of her and you make her tongue like the pen of a ready writer. That the issue of your life and your words begin to utter out of her mouth. Begin to come forth out of her mouth. Both, O Lord, in the language of the Spirit. Hallelujah. And in the language of men as well. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Yeah. Yeah. Satoro mosite and anamakasa. Libendere bicotoro moshi prende kiesta. The overwhelming glory of heaven in this house. The overwhelming glory of heaven in this life. The outpouring of the Spirit without reservation, without limitation. Lurestete namakzestust. Just find yourself worshiping Him and praising Him and giving thanks for all the good things that He's done for you. Just find yourself being captivated and caught up with His love. I'm telling you right now, people, when folks learn how to enjoy the presence of the Lord, oh my, hallelujah, it gets big. See, I told you she was coming right back. Jesus, touch Judah, strengthen him. Father, raise him up to be a mighty man of God. Father, raise him up a mighty warrior in your kingdom. Father, raise him up a mighty man of faith, full of faith and power, who goes about doing wonders and miracles among the people. Are you doing good? You need any prayer about anything particular? You need obedience? Everybody needs that. Everyone needs it. Praise God for the spirit of obedience. And I pray that you learn it early in life and you get it and you get it perfectly and you never lose it. Hallelujah. Jesus. Jesus. Thank you for your anointing, Judah's life. Thank you for bringing forth praise in Judah. Thank you for the outpouring of the Holy Ghost right through Judah's belly, right through his little spirit. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Right now, touch. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, for the anointing. Oh, we love you so much. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Jesus. 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 Be healed. Be healed. Be healed. Be healed. Be healed. I give you my peace. Just take it. And I will seek the Lord while he may be found. And I will call upon him while he's near. Yes, I will seek the Lord while he may be found. And I will call upon him while he's near. My refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. I will seek the Lord while he may be found. I'll call upon him while he is near. I will seek the Lord while he may be found. I will call upon him while he is near. My refuge, my sanctuary, my shelter from the storm. My refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. I will see the Lord while he may be found. I will call upon him while he's near. I will seek the Lord while he may be found. I will call upon him while he's near. My refuge, my shelter, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. My refuge, my dwelling place, my shelter from I will seek the Lord while he may be found. I will call upon him while he's near. I will seek the Lord while he may be found. I will call upon him while he's near. My refuge, my refuge, oh, my dwelling place, you're my shelter from the storm. You're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. My refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my refuge from the storm. I will seek the Lord while he be strengthened right now by the Spirit. In your inner being. Filled continually. For that is the place of consecration. For that is the place of surrender. And that is the place of submission to God. It's a relationship. It's interacting with Him. Just letting Him come and touch you and fill you and overwhelm you with His presence. I will see the Lord. While he may be found, I will call upon him while he's near. You're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. You're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. I will seek you, Lord, while he may be found. I will call upon him while he's near. My refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Oh, my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. I will seek you, Lord, while you may be found. I will call upon you while you're near. Oh, I will seek you, Lord, while you may be found. I will call upon you while you You're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. You're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we just thank you that you bring us into a place of just coming together and just waiting on you and just worshiping you and just letting you move in our midst, speak through our lives. And Father, we thank you for the manifestation of the Holy Ghost that is given to every man. Oh, Lord, that the outpouring of your Spirit, the word of prophecy, and Lord, those things that belong to the word of knowledge and the word of wisdom and the discerning of spirits and tongues and interpretation may begin to be exercised through all you people. I will seek the Lord while he may be found. I will call upon him while he's near. Father, I thank you for Brad's life and that he's consecrated himself to serve you and to walk with you, to be used by you. Father, I ask you for a great outpouring of authority and divine power in his life. Father, I ask you to take a hold of him, Lord, and bring him into a whole nother dimension of faith. In Jesus' name. Yeah.
All the way.
Yeah. Pastor Rineshikisht. Yeah. Yeah. Modestanamea. Modestea. It's just revival talk. It's just revival language. It's just revival reflex. It's revival repose. It's revival response. That is, it happens in each person's life. Just like it's happening right now in Brad's life. Things begin to break open. And I've found over and again, the more people begin to do in the kingdom, the more begin to participate, the more they begin to see their need in the kingdom, the more softened they become to the Lord. And when you begin to become softened to the Lord, he can come and touch you, and there'll be a great response. Hallelujah. From you. And I'm going to tell you, with that response from you, there's a greater response from heaven. There's a greater response from heaven. You want this in your life. You want this in your life. You want this in your life. Sometimes people have to go through a lot of people, as it were. They've got to go through a lot of uncertainty. They've got to go through some tough places. But if you don't just self-justify, but if you cry out to God and say, I want to get this right, and you hear his voice, you'll hear his call, and you respond rightly before him, I tell you, everything about your life will be straightened out, be put into order. So that the Lord can come and do with you the things which he's purposed to do. Thank you, Jesus. I'll seek the Lord while he may be found. I will call upon him while he's near. I will seek the Lord while he may be found. I will call upon him while he's near. My refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. My refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Father, we just ask you now in Jesus' name, take hold of Bobby's life. Fill it with everything of God that you've purposed. All your fullness, all your glory. She may begin to function, operate in the glory of heaven and the anointing of your Holy Spirit like never before. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for this hunger and thirsting after righteousness. Thank you, Father, for this great change. Thank you, Father, for the great outpouring of your Spirit to this life. With greater richness, brota bandai, with greater force, libandele vexteya, mambandele be, and the things of the past, and the change of the past, and the hindrance of the past, and the posture of the past has no place in the future, no place in the now, because now this is the vessel of righteousness and of honor, a place where the Spirit of the living God dwells and from which he flows forth freely from. Hallelujah. Delight yourself. Be strengthened by the Spirit right now in your inner being. Be strengthened by the power of the living God to begin to live out everything that he has called you to do and purposed you to do. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Ura satarana moshekaya. Ura shatorana majesht. Increase. Increase, Michael, with the increase of God. I bless you in the name of Jesus Christ. I bless you in the name of Jesus. Father, I thank you for your authority and your power and your divine anointing that is given to us to do those things that you've called us to do. Uji jaradeya. Uji jaradeya. Uji jaradeya. Fire anointing. Fire. 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 Father, I thank you for the ability to speak peace to every storm. Father, I thank you for the authority to move mountains out of the way, to declare things when they come to pass. Do it mightily, do this work mightily, I pray, Father, right here. Some of the things that she was saying, she was addressing the powers of darkness, saying, I break the power of every lying spirit, every harassing, tormenting thing that has tried to destroy my family.
Yes, Father.
So she was saying,
yes, Lord. Yes, Father. Yes, Lord. I know in Jesus' name, I will not sit by lethargically. In Jesus' name, I will rise. I will shine. In Jesus' name.
Mandalay. Mandeste. Mandesteri. Mandoste. Fire. Authority. Ability to stand in the Master's plan, to speak his word, to live his life, to do His will, to do His works in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Fastened together with the Lord. Fastened. Fastened. Fasten yourself together with Him. Fasten. Fasten yourself. Take hold of Miles, Father. Father, thank you for your blessing on his life. I thank you for the great changes, oh God. As you bring a person into a place to sit at your feet and to hear your voice. To take a hold of the mind of the Spirit and the mind of Christ to live by your word, oh God. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, for this wonderful work. Now, in Jesus' name. Now, Mondeste. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Zudaraneshe. What's up? All for you, Lord Jesus. All for you, Lord Jesus. All for you, Lord Jesus. Every dimension of this life, all for you, Lord Jesus. Take hold of every part. There's nothing left out. Thank you, Jesus, that you wore a crown of thorns that we might wear a crown of glory. Father, thank you that you were willing to so see your son bruised that we might have your peace. And Father, I thank you for the anointing in this life to contend for it. In Jesus' name, increase. Imbratusika. Increased. An increased flow. An increased passion. An increased hunger. In the name of Jesus. And everything to try to stand in the way has to get out the way right now. And everything of the past is erased and is removed far, far away to move forward today. Those things that only Christ Jesus can do. And He's going to do it through you. He's going to do it through you. Father, heals us in such a way that we feel no ill effect of that former thing. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you so much for handling. Blessed in the name of Jesus Christ with the riches of heaven. Blessed with the glory flow of the Spirit. With an authority and anointing that only Christ Jesus can give. Father, we thank you. O Rasabadiah, that as you live, O God, we are privileged to live in you. And we thank you, Father God, for Annalyn's heart to be willing to live only your life. Let that wonderful glory, let that wonderful spirit, let that wonderful anointing flow like a mighty stream. Find all strength. Find all power. Find all divine ability. Raphael in Christ Jesus. Branda say, to live the life of an overcomer. Ha, to live the life, Uresata, of one born of the Spirit. Ha, full of God, full of His power, full of His divine authority. Thank you, Jesus, for the anointing. Increased. 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 How are you doing? You want the Lord Jesus to touch you? Do you want the Lord Jesus to touch you? You do? But that's good. Let Him touch you right now. What's your name? Would Jesus touch Angela right now? Touch her with Your presence, Lord, so that the world can't have her. Touch her, Lord, with Your presence, so that she'll give her whole life to You. Angela, just lift your hands towards heaven. Close your eyes. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Just lift your hands up towards heaven. Let Jesus touch you. He wants to touch you. Thank You, Jesus. Everything about this life, oh God, captivated by You, Lord, taken a hold of by You, changed by You, Lord, from the crown of her head to the soles of her feet. May she know nothing more and nothing less than the beauty and the splendor of living a life for You, Lord. In the name of Jesus, everything of this world and every claim of hell, I break it now in Jesus' name. That everything about this life can shine with the beauty of the presence of the Lord. Fire of God, fire of His presence right now. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Jesus. That You take us and You wash us with Your blood, and You cleanse us from every stain of sin and from every ill effect of the world. Thank You, Father, for this glorious life, Your life. Filled right now in the name of Jesus. Filled up with heaven. Filled up with heaven. Right now in Jesus' name. Filled with heaven. Right now in Jesus' name. Filled with heaven. Right now in Jesus' name. Hallelujah.
I will seek the Lord while He may be found. I will call upon Him while He is near. My refuge, my dwelling place, my shelter from